LaRouche emphasizes this in his method of, his method of everything, method of economics, forecasting, politics, is that truth only exists in the form of polemics against evil and falsehood. I hope I'll give you some idea what that's supposed to mean. Now, in 2001, I was a congressional candidate for the Democratic nomination. I won't bore you with all the details of that. The most exciting thing, or I guess the most outstanding thing about that election campaign is that the election was held on September 11, 2001, so nobody really remembers much about it. There were other events that day. But there was this, you can look at my website, which is still sitting there. I wanted to begin right off the bat, since we have guests from MIT and others, to read you one of the jokes I used in my campaign website. Not the best one, but it's relevant to tonight's discussion. Okay. The MIT economist was on a transatlantic flight in a four-engine jet. Then suddenly, boom, on the public address system, the captain announced, "Ladies and gentlemen, we just lost engine number one. However, there's no cause for panic. Our flight will be delayed only 1 hour." Then a few minutes later, boom, then the captain said, "Ladies and gentlemen, that was engine number two. Please do not be alarmed. We still have two engines left, and our flight will only be delayed 2 hours." Then the economist raised an eyebrow. Shortly thereafter, boom, the captain came on again. "Well, folks, we just blown engine number three. Though we're a bit concerned here in the cockpit, please remain calm. Our flight will now be delayed 4 hours. Then the economist started thinking to himself, lost one engine, we delayed 1 hour. Lost two engines, we're delayed 2 hours. Minus three engines, we're delayed 4 hours. Then he pulled out his laptop and he drew a graph and did a series of calculations, plotted a projection. And then as he triumphantly arrived at the final equation and his PC printed out the results, boom! Then the economist unbuckled the seatbelt. He stood up and he shouted to all the other passengers, "Damn it, we're going to be up here all day." If you like that one, I have more, but we'll get to them later. Okay, why am I picking on MIT? Well, it's not just MIT.
MIT economics?
No, MIT method. Everything. But mainly science. We're going to focus on math tonight. But it pervades everything. And it's not just MIT, it's just MIT happens to be a very prestigious institution. You know, where you're supposed to learn science and mathematics, engineering, economics. You should know that some of the most evil ideology in the world that's responsible for the death of millions and probably billions of people was formulated at that place. Norbert Wiener, who's the father of information theory, his influence, you know, just pervades every level of academic science, and, you know, deliberately so. He was a professor at Harvard, and I guess he later went over to MIT. And I don't want to go into a lot of details right now, but we can take up some of it. We had a couple of presentations about it earlier in the year about Norbert Wiener's information theory. But I think the most relevant quote, it sort of gives you the spirit of Wiener, is that he said, it doesn't matter whether I am sending a signal or giving a command to a machine or an animal or a person. It's all the transmission of a signal, a message, to create a certain response from the other end. The idea that he could say that, whether it was an animal, a machine, or a person, tells you a lot about him. And LaRouche, in several of his writings, when he discusses his scientific method, he states that he got an advanced copy of this book from a guy who was dating Norbert Wiener's daughter at the time. I guess he was about in his late 20s or early, but early 30s when that happened. And he said that the whole part about the design of machines to do work, you know, different kinds of, I guess, command and control, that was completely fascinating. But when he started to apply this same idea to the way humans relate to one another and the way humans think, he became increasingly infuriated with the idea. I mean, everything is computers. Everything is information, IT, etc. Not that computers are bad, obviously. You know, you could use them to greatly enhance the productivity of manufacturing. You could use them to communicate profound ideas if you have a human being on the other end, right? Or, well, both ends, actually. What are these computers mostly used for? Aside from aiming missiles at people and that sort of thing, which is kind of problematic. Mostly it's used to keep track of these financial transactions that are destroying our economy. And the ideology of the information society, this information theory, it has been used to destroy the cognitive powers of the population by a network of very nasty people that you're somewhat familiar with from what Matthew went through. The thing you realize is that all human history is most profitably seen from the standpoint of a battle between those that believe a small elite should rule over the mass of humanity. And they've designed, they've maintained political systems to do that, versus those who believe that the human being is sacred, that the human being has a capacity that makes him in the image of God. I mean, this is in various degrees. Obviously, this is a fundamental idea in Christianity, but it's also in Judaism and Islam, and frankly, any place in the world where there's human beings. Ultimately, you get to this idea, this conception, but it was most profoundly developed and realized in the culture in European civilization. And, I mean, that was the fight to establish the nation state in Europe. That's where the concept was developed, and the first modern nation state was France. Then later, the first republic, the first nation that was established, you know, in law to exist solely for the benefit of its members, of its citizens. That was implicit in the founding of the nation of France, but it was explicitly in the Constitution of the United States and in the Declaration of Independence. Now, this battle is fought out on the arenas of politics, obviously, but every area of human endeavor in science and mathematics and art and music, you know, everywhere there's people, you know, there's this, ultimately this fight, this conflict is there. And you know, we're fortunate to live in a time where, I mean, I won't go into a whole lot of detail about the financial collapse that we're in the middle of right now. I mean, I think Matt gave you an idea of that. And we can talk more about it if we get time in the question and answer period. The main issue is, what are you going to do about it? And how can you be effective in changing the course of history as it is moving right now? Now, we're very fortunate that we have Mr. LaRouche still with us. I mean, obviously, I think that. I've been working with him for 23 years. And I'd like to give you some idea of where he's coming from so that you can be part of this battle. Hopefully, you'll be on the side of the humanists, the people who believe in this idea of human freedom, versus being an enemy of the a victim of this oligarchy, this financial elite that has tried to suppress human creativity throughout the centuries. Now, so what I want to do is get across to you some idea what Lyndon LaRouche's method in economics and science in general, and also other areas, give you some idea of that. And you know, one important, as Matt was describing, one crucial area is in the this idea of how the calculus, how mathematics in general has developed, has really developed over the centuries. What's the standpoint from which you have to approach it to actually get a valid representation of universal law? Now, I mean, LaRouche is mainly an economist. That's his area of expertise. Now, I'll mention, throw out a few things for you. Does anybody know what area of human activity is known as the sweet science?
Wine tasting?
No. I don't know why, but that's the name for boxing. You know, when you hit people with your fists. Maybe that's where he got it from. Okay, now in contrast, which area of human activity is known as the dismal science?
Mathematics.
No. Close.
Economics.
The dismal science. I forget who it was that called it that. Maybe it's Thomas Malthus. You may have heard of Malthus. He's the guy that said that the agricultural space increases arithmetically, whereas human population increases geometrically, which means that you're always going to run into food shortages. This is going to cause massive famines. It's going to cause massive death and make the population go down until, that's pretty dismal, right?
Maybe because it's really cloudy up in England.
It's foggy in London. Okay. Then there's Adams. I mean, this guy is, I don't want to say he's a patron saint, but that kind of thinking dominates the culture now. If you ask people, I'll ask you now. What's the main fact about human population right now? If you have any kind of idea of that. Yeah. How many more people does the world need? Put it that way.
About a trillion.
A trillion? Would most of you agree we need more, many, many more people?
Yeah, why not?
Sure. Okay, some people do. Who thinks there's too many people in the world? You think there's too many people?
You'd like to.
Who's that? Huh? All right, get them back. So you think there's too many people? Okay. Right. So you would agree with Malthus, pretty much, right? Okay. Now, here's the thing. Why do you think that? I will tell you. How old are you? If I can ask, roughly. 28? Okay. I can tell you for a fact that ideology was planted in society in the last 50 years to convince people, young people, that they had no future, that there's too many people in the world, and that we have to reduce the population. This is not the first time, but that was one of the beautiful things that came out of MIT. These characters, Forrester and Meadows, they developed this computer model for the world economy. And they did, this was back in the late 60s, and they did a projection as to what, you know, where is human society headed, right? They had the inputs of the materials and what you need, how much of the resources you're using, and population growth, and the computer spit out the result that there's too many people. You know, we're going to run out of everything. Now, a computer is only as good as the programming, right? I mean, assuming the programming is good, what's the other thing that can cause the computer to spit out lies? If you program assumptions into the computer that are lies, then what you're going to get, you know, what's the term? Garbage in, garbage out?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. These guys, the assumption that they programmed into the computer was that there would be absolutely no technological progress for 30 years. Okay. Now that's MIT for you. Why would they do that? Isn't it called the Massachusetts Institute of Technology? They've developed all this computers and engineering and these bicycles that can go 60 miles an hour, right? And so forth. You had that guy Lester Thoreau, the brilliant economist, who said that he wrote this very popular book in the 70s that the economy is a zero-sum game. You know, if somebody gains in the economy, then somebody else has to lose. Lester Thoreau, he's MIT economist number one. Okay. Now, all right, so they programmed this computer to that there'd be no progress for 30 years. And the result that it spit out was that there was too many people in the world, there's going to be too many people, we're going to run out of everything, it's going to be a disaster. Which, I mean, you can't blame the computer for that, can you? Why would they program a computer to do that? Well, we can assume incompetence, but you have to be, like, really retarded to think that. I mean, if you've got a degree in economics and, you know, computer science, et cetera, and you program a computer that way, you're either really incompetent or you're what? Or you think there's too many people in the world, therefore you want to program the computer to prove it. And then you can make up a list of who you want to get rid of. And that's why you and other people think there's too many people in the world, whether you said so or not. I used to think that. I remember them bringing a computer into a classroom in the, I think it was this, like, third grade. It was supposed to show the relationship between the resources and the population, how the economy was going to work. It had all these flashing lights and graphs and everything. Right? And I remember that there was a specific result they wanted to get. They were telling people, asking the kids, you know, what do you want to do? You want to increase the oil production? Well, that's going to use up energy here. You know, it's going to pollute the environment here. He said, so what do you want to do? You want to build more nuclear plants? You know, stuff like that. You want to reduce the rate of consumption, blah, blah, blah. Right. Now, one particularly smart young man got, hey, why don't we stop the population growth? And then once that happened, everything was magical. Everything smoothed out. It was nice and wonderful. So this is like, what, 1972 or something. This is like 2 years after Earth Day, where they took all the people that had been pulled into the anti-war movement, you know, the hippies and free love, et cetera, druggies, et cetera, and some decent people who wanted to do something useful to stop, you know, their buddies from getting killed or going over for nothing, and they turned them into environmentalists. This is the big problem with baby boomers. Now, hopefully, in the future, we can do some classes about some of the ideology, some of the problems that have been that has plagued the baby boomer generation. I'm sort of like a baby boomer, like right at the end of it. Right? They generally say, you know, from 45 to 64 is baby boomers, so I'm kind of a very, very young boomer. Or old tweener, or whatever, if that matters. But this was done deliberately. Because you look at the 60s, what was going on? We were putting up spaceships, we were going to the moon, and we had like 7 or 8 missions where we hit people landing on the moon, doing scientific experiments. You know, they had this Land Rover driving around on the moon. You imagine what it's like to see that when you're like 8 or 9 years old? Mm-hmm. That's exciting. He said, man, wow, you know, we can conquer space. We can do great things. And then all of a sudden, they just stopped. You may not know that. Some of you may think we never went to the moon. That was all like Hollywood production to fool people. I've met people that think that. So that you know, from that was like 69 to 73, where we're going to the moon. But the whole process, which was initiated by John Kennedy's commitment, you know, when he announced, we're going to put a man on the moon by the end of the decade. And obviously, he only lived a couple of years after he said that. But the mobilization of the resources, there was a massive flooding of money and commitment of resources to training kids to be scientists and engineers. It was tremendous optimism. Now, from an economic standpoint, the general estimate has been that for every dollar we put into the space program, we increase the productivity by $14 of the economy. Right? It's tremendous, you know. I mean, you don't have to be a genius in economics to know that if you spend $1 and you get $14 back, that's a pretty good investment, right? So why was it shut down? You gotta ask yourself that. Because if you look at it from the standpoint of someone like a George Shultz, right? Or let's say Prescott Bush, George Bush's grandfather, because, you know, Bush is really kind of brain damaged. I doubt that he sits and thinks about these things. He probably has just enough trouble getting across the room without falling. I mean, this guy was attacked by a pretzel. But his grandfather, who funneled money from the bank he worked for, funneled it to the Nazi party in the 30s, right? This is the kind of person. Well, it means that even the high level. He's like a lackey. He worked for this guy, Avril Harriman, who was much more evil, consciously evil. And these other, you know, financial oligarch figures. They see this kind of scientific progress and the effect it has on the population, right? The idea of little black kids thinking they could grow up to be scientists. And what did that fill them with rage? So they put their resources into stopping this cult. And there's documentation of this. There's this thing that was issued, it was called the Rappaport Report. And there was another, I think it was another report from the Tavistock Institute, I have to look this up, from Britain, that attacked the way that technological optimism was being fostered by the space program. Right, they had spent a lot of money, and I don't want to get too far off here. We're going to talk about calculus, but I shouldn't go off on tangents, you know. These oligarchs had spent millions of dollars in the late 40s and 50s to make sure that the baby boomer generation rejected science, right? I don't know if you know this, but they made dozens and maybe hundreds of movies, you know, where nuclear waste or radiation, you know, I mean, you know, Spider-Man got bit by a radioactive spider and he had superpowers, right? That was supposed to be the good side of science, right? But on the bad side, all these, like, there's this movie called The Beginning of the End, where these grasshoppers get into this nuclear radiation experiment for growing giant vegetables. And all of a sudden, Chicago is swarmed with these giant grasshoppers that are just devastating everything in their path. And, I mean, there's hundreds of movies like that from the 50s and 60s. Now, despite all... Yeah, that's another one. Story about that. Anyway, despite all of that, you had all these people who wanted to be scientists and kids wanted to be astronauts and tremendous optimism, and they had to kill it. And I mean, it's pretty, it's except for our movement, it's pretty much dead. What do people use technology for now? What is all this information technology used for? What do most kids at the age of 12, what's their relationship to this computer science? Video games. And the computers are programming them to be killers. Getting them ready for, to join the Army or the Marines and, you know, what was that slogan? Go to exotic foreign lands, meet exciting and usual people and kill them. That's a t-shirt that they, you never saw that? It's a t-shirt. It says, join the Army. Visit strange exotic lands, meet exciting unusual people and kill them. Now, see, in the 60s, the anti-war people would put that t-shirt on. But when I was organizing at the airport back in the 80s, the guys joining the military were wearing that shirt proudly. To give you some sense of the change that occurred. All right, so I'm going to give you some kind of context of what we're dealing with right now. All the evil things that we're suffering right now. This is not natural. This was deliberately created. And this business of Wiener and this information theory, it's at the heart of it. But it's part of a historic fight that goes back to the ancient Greeks. It goes back further than that, but that's the part that's where the crucial battle is, because we have this conflict between, well, if we have time, we can go into Plato, which, you know, created philosophy. Socrates, Plato, that tradition, these ancient Greek astronomers and geometers, they created science. Going back to that tradition is the remedy for the problems that we got now. Every major fundamental advance in science in the last 2,000 years has come from people that have gone back to the wellspring of Socrates and Plato, the method that they represented in order to make their breakthroughs. Now, what did I say earlier? Truth only exists in the form of polemics against evil and falsehood. There's another quote. I don't think LaRouche said this, but somebody else. Maybe it was Jonathan Tenenbaum. I remember I heard a lecture he gave. He said something. The only thing I really remember from that lecture was he said that the universe is made of work. How does that strike you? Have you ever thought about what the universe is made of? Anyway, we'll talk about that some. Now, LaRouche has the record, an incomparable record of economic forecasting. When I was running for Congress, I was in about 27 public debates. What happened to this thing? Did it not work? Yeah, I was in about 27 public debates, and I always would start out about LaRouche as being the number one economic forecaster, and his warning that the financial system is collapsing. And this started freaking out people in the media. They wouldn't cover anything I said, hardly, because that was all the first thing out of my mouth, and the last thing out of my mouth. My whole point of the campaign was everything that, you know, they should be hearing LaRouche's ideas coming out of my mouth. Right? They tried to accuse me of being brainwashed. Right? Now, here I am. I mean, look, let me tell you one thing LaRouche said in 2001. Aside from the fact that he said that we're going to have a Reichstag fire that's going to be used to tear up the Constitution, Ashcroft would be all over it. He said that. And you got to admit, that's what we got. The day I announced my campaign was going to begin, LaRouche did a webcast. LaRouche did a webcast where he said, if the economic policy that I'm advocating isn't implemented soon, I can guarantee you we'll be in a war before the end of the year. How many people here in the summer of 2001 expected we'd be in a war before the end of the year? You can raise your hands.
What's September 11th?
Yeah, 2001, summertime. I think it was July 24th.
Right, yeah.
What'd you say?
No, I remember that, and then he also talked about you have a war break out in the Middle East.
Yeah, it said it was going to be targeted against Muslims. And he nailed it. What's this? Gotta clean this thing.
Yeah.
I'm showing you this. This is a good example because it's graphical. This is a comparison of economic forecasts that was made. The forecasts were made in September 1980. I'm not exactly sure where this is. If this is, oh, it says calendar quarter. Okay, so I guess the prediction starts here, I think. Okay, for all of these different econometric models, Evans, Data Resources, Wharton School of Economics, Chase Econometrics, that's associated with Chase, it was Chase Manhattan, now it's called Morgan Chase, JP Morgan Chase. That's their forecast of what would happen as a result of Paul Volcker's interest rate policy. He raised the interest rates in late, I think it was 79. Right? Now, you know, financial oligarchs and rich people in general, they like high interest rates, right? You know why? Because they have lots of money already. So they keep it in banks. So they collect the interest rate. That's one reason. Now, the reason financial oligarchs or the top level oligarchy in particular wanted high interest rates is because they wanted to implement a policy in the United States of controlled disintegration. And those are the exact words that came out of Volcker's mouth. Controlled disintegration of the economy. If you have high interest rates, then that means you can't borrow money unless you already got a lot of money. All right? You can't borrow money. If you're going to run a steel plant and you need to borrow money, you know, and the interest rate is 19, 20, 25%, you don't make that kind of profit margin producing steel, right? Or building, you know, manufacturing buildings or anything. I mean, you can make that rate of profit if you sell drugs, if you run a very creative house of prostitution, probably. If you're a financial speculator, right, engaged in insider trading, you can make 30% profit, right? But besides that, they got special interest rates anyway. All right. But for the normal average person, we wanted to buy a house and it's 25% interest rates, forget it. Can't do it. If you're trying to run a business or run a farm and there's 25% interest rates, you can't do anything. So anyway, LaRouche forecast the effect of this. Okay. This is all these highfalutin computer information technology financial geniuses, right? This is what their predictions, how it went.
Is that like University of Penn Wharton?
Yeah. I forget where Data Resources at Evans are. That's New York. Okay, this was the published forecast of Executive Intelligence Review. And this is what actually happened. What does that tell you? Look at that. Every single one of these is pretty much a straight line, right? Whatever the trend was that their data told them, they extrapolated it out for 2 years, right? And then these guys were really optimistic. They said, really going high, and then it's going to slow down a little bit, but phew. All right, and this is what LaRouche did. Now look, you see how this curve dips down, then it goes up, and then curves over, and then down again, and then down, and then over, level a little bit, and then down. What does this curve do? I mean, the magnitudes are different, but look at the shape of the curve. And that's a relevant issue when we're talking about calculus, right? Well, you know, the singular point here, and here, and here, and here, and here, and here. Well, this one, not quite, well, you know. Obviously, you look at that, it's the same shape. Now, how come to do that? And these guys are often Deep Space Nine, something like that. Well, it's an issue of method. Now, LaRouche's method, I think Matt might have read this quote before. I'll read it again. I'll back up a little bit. I've already stressed that fundamental progress in scientific knowledge comes from moving upward from an existing hierarchy of presumed mathematical scientific knowledge into the higher meta-mathematical domains beyond any established level of knowledge of already tested regions of mere mathematical formalism. And he says, thus, Vernadsky defined the principle of life and the implications of the history of fossils, and then applied the same approach to define the principled nature of the existence of the noosphere. I'll explain that part later. Similarly, I have used my experience of what nearly five decades has been shown to have been a relatively uniquely successful top-down approach, an approach comparable to Vernadsky's approach to defining the biosphere, for defining the factors which must be considered in long-range economic forecasting. The significance of my method of economic forecasting, which contrasts it to the failures of the usual sets of my putative rivals, has been that, listen to this part, rather than attempting to extrapolate from what so-called ordinary statistical methods treat as trends perceived within the existing set of prevalent axiomatic assumptions, I look for the critical point at which the fallacies embedded in the combination of the axiomatic implication of currently practiced beliefs and related strongly promoted patterns of shifts in the setting of political economic trends will, if continued, generate a future breakdown in any economy which sticks indefinitely to such combined trends and policies of practice. I'll throw this last part in. My top-down approach in economic forecasting leads to a rigorous definition of the role of the human creative processes in determining the characteristic distinctions of society from animal ecology. Remember what I said about LaRouche making it his life's mission to destroy this Norbert Wiener business? I mean, he mentions several times this idea of top-down approach. The way he refuted this is sort of like a sketch of the idea that he presented to refute this information theory. First of all, I mean, his definition of economics, I mean, obviously, he would reject this idea that economics is the dismal science. I hope you do too. Or at least, I mean, you know, it shouldn't be dismal, it should be happy, shouldn't it? I mean, it says in the Declaration of Independence that we have the right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, right? So, economics should be the happy science, the optimistic science. Okay. Now, from LaRouche's standpoint, economics is about the successful reproduction of the human species. And you know I don't mean simple reproduction. You know, people having babies and stuff. What he means is you have a improving quality of conditions of life for human beings, an improved number of human beings, more of them, living at a higher standard of living with a higher life expectancy, lifespan, better conditions of life. And most importantly, developed minds. Every person should have the right and opportunity to develop their mental capacities to the maximum, to pursue whatever endeavor they want to get into. That's what he would say is happiness. We can talk more about happiness later. It's a good subject, right? So how do you do that? Well, see, now this gets to this question about, remember I mentioned this thing about what's the universe made of? LaRouche says the substance of economics is the increase of the rate of increase of potential relative population density. Now, population density, that's obviously how many people you have that live in a square mile, a square kilometer, right? Potential population density, that's a function of the technology that you have, right? And the relative means, well, you know, not all the land is the same. You know, if you live in the middle of Antarctica, it's a little bit different from living in the middle of Kansas in terms of, you know, how many people you could sustain, because it's a lot rougher environment in Antarctica. But potential, the crucial issue is the potential, which is a function of the technology, right? The technology that you have determines what you can apply to human activity, what resources you use up, what rate of usage of the of resources, the conditions of life. I remember in the early 80s, we had figures about population density. And this is just a rough, this isn't potential population density, this is just actual. But it gives you an indication of the complete fraud of this idea that there's too many people in the world. I think New Jersey had a population density of about 26 people per square kilometer. Belgium had a population density of 930 per square kilometer. And Africa as a whole, I believe, had a population density of like 2 people per square kilometer. Where would you rather live? Maybe I should say it differently. That shows you this idea. I mean, what's the one place that they always say is too many people? Yeah. Well, Asia, yeah, but Africa, right? You always see pictures of, you know, thousands of people starving. Is that because there's too many people? Obviously not. It's because of the deliberate denial of technological progress to those nations. People are being murdered. This has been, you know, this is going on historically for hundreds of years. It's absolutely, completely deliberate on the part of these financial institutions and these oligarchs to kill Africans, starve them. All they care about in Africa, aside from the lions and tigers, well, no, not tigers, lions and giraffes and all that, the scenery, you know, safari hunting, the raw materials. In fact, they set up these game preserves, right, to preserve the natural state in certain areas of Africa. They got game parks the size of Massachusetts there, right? They straddle the borders to make sure that the principle of national sovereignty is violated, right? How can you maintain the security of your border if there's a giant game park that's run by the British Empire right in the middle of your country, right? Right on the border between you and another country. And this is done deliberately to not only is it used to deny people the use of the resources, but it's also used as a staging ground to assassinate Africans that want to change that. So this idea of potential population density, think about this. It's a function of your technology, that determines what you can do, how many people you can support. And this is a measure of economic progress, not just what the potential population density is, but the rate of increase of potential population density and the rate of the rate of increase. Now let's back up a little bit here. LaRouche wanted to refute this guy, Wiener. So what does he do? He said, all right, you're saying it doesn't matter if I send a signal to a human being or an animal or a machine. I'll tell them what to do and they do it, right? So what does LaRouche say? He said, all right, why don't we, let's take all the economic activity, you know, production of materials, of manufacturing of machines, all the economic activity that goes on, and let's mechanize it all. Let's replace all the human labor with robots. I like robots, but you see where this is headed. All right, so the robots are going to do all the work. I guess the people can enjoy the benefits of it. So they're going to extract the materials. They're going to manufacture the steel and alloys, etc. They're going to build the machines. They're going to build machines that build machines. You know, they're going to build buildings. They're going to build factories. They got to build robots too, right? Because machines wear down. Now there's some advantages, right? Robot doesn't have to sleep, right? He needs a little bit of downtime, but, you know, robot will keep working. Robot's not going to go on strike. Robot doesn't have to go home at night. Robot doesn't need money to send his kid to college, right? This might work out pretty good, right? Now, LaRouche demonstrate what happens if you had the economy run, it was all robots. What do you think happens?
Terminator
2? Unfortunately, Schwarzenegger is the governor of the largest state.
That's the information technology.
Yeah. That's beautiful irony. Ugly irony. Alright. Okay, here's what's going to happen. Right? The robots are digging up whatever you need. You know, iron ore, etc. What's going to happen? It's a certain level of resources that are available that the robots can dig up. But if they dig up the iron ore for 10 or 20 years, what ends up happening? Eventually, it's going to be, they have to have more and more robots doing the digging, right? Because they're going to run out. Or they're not going to run out, but it's going to become more and more expensive. More and more of the resources of this enterprise is going to be tied up in extraction of materials because the quality of the ore is going to be less and less.
Can you say it again? I don't quite understand.
Yeah, the sector of the robot economy is digging up the ore. As they use it up, it's being used, right? They're not going to be able to, you know, after 10 years or 20 years or whatever, eventually it's going to become cost prohibitive to get the amount of steel you need to run the economy. You can do recycling and whatnot, but ultimately you're dependent on a certain amount of this resource. What's going to happen? Especially if you have like a coal economy, you're burning coal to generate electricity, or burning fossil fuel, what's going to happen? The economy is going to break down. They aren't going to have enough. Because your level of technology is going to determine your resources, what you can use. And if, now this is the big if, now see this is where Forrester Meadows comes in. Right? There's no progress. If there's no invention of new machines to increase the productivity of the robot labor, what's going to happen? It all goes kaboom. But this gets to the fundamental point about LaRouche's method. Economic progress isn't something that happens in an economy. It's the essence of economy. It's the substance of economy. That's why you have an economy. If you look at it from the standpoint of the biosphere, right? If you're living at a hunting and gathering mode of existence, the world can sustain maybe what is it, 10 million or 100 million people maximum. If they're just growing the food that they see, you know, they bang an antelope over the head and cook it, right? In fact, they'll be competing with baboons, right, or other animals. They'll be living in hideously bad conditions, and they're not going to live very long. But instead of having 10 million people or 100 million people, we've got, what, 6 billion? Why do we have 6 billion? Because of the series of scientific breakthroughs that have been made over the centuries that have enabled us to increase our control over nature, or our intervention in nature, however you want to put it. A lot of things we don't control. But we have a relative mastery of principles of science that enables us to support 6 billion people. And we could support a hell of a lot more than that if we use the technology that we already have. You know, if we built those nuclear plants, you know, that Jane Fonda and the, you know, 10-foot cockroaches convinced people that we didn't need in the 70s. Well, we had a class about that. You know something about this nuclear power thing. We should deal with that like a separate issue almost. But nuclear fusion, but just using nuclear fission like they do in Japan or France. We could support billions more people. So, but the essence of the economy is this progress. That's what it's about. It's about scientific discovery. It's about the individual human being creating a new idea, discovering a new universal physical principle that when it is applied to human activity, as in the form of a machine tool or something analogous to that, increases the potential relative population density. And if you want to have a successful economy, if you want to have successful reproduction of the human race, if you want your kids and grandkids and great-grandkids to have it better than you, then you better ensure that you have policies, economic policies, science policies, social policies, whatever that means. Every policy of your society has got to foster the increase of potential population density. And it's got to create creative individuals, people who can make these discoveries. Otherwise, you end up like the robots or the animals who do the same thing, you know, one generation to the next. They don't increase their potential population density. Sometimes man increases it for them, right? We're the only being, only creature on the planet that does that. That's the in essence of human beings. Okay, so let's talk about one of these advances from the standpoint of all these polemics that I've been launching about evil and falsehood and MIT and all of that. I tried to get into MIT. I got admitted to MIT. I went there to see if I wanted to go to school there. And I'll tell you why I didn't go to MIT. This is in 79. Same time they had that giant movie about nuclear reactors melting down and burning through the earth down to China. 1979. The China Syndrome, starring Jane Fonda. It was in the news, right? I went to MIT, right? I'm from Virginia, so I come up here. It's the first time I've ever been to Boston. Well, it was the second time, but I was a little kid before. So I go to MIT, and they're going to have me show me around the place for a day. Now, I met the guy who's like the, admissions guy. He's white. From that point on, the only people I'd been introduced to for a whole 24 hours were all black. Do you believe it? I could not believe it. And I'm going, damn, I didn't know MIT was a black school. What are all these white folks doing here? Are they students too? I swear to God. That's why I didn't go there. You can figure out what that has to do with it. Maybe it correlates to your experience.
I don't know about that one.
Huh?
I don't know.
It's pretty bad, isn't it?
We need to work on calculus.
Yeah, we do. I just thought I'd say that. I don't think it's irrelevant. Okay, now who invented calculus? Class?
Not Newton.
Is this not going to start a fight? No, too bad.
Let's start.
Huh?
Archimedes had some of the first ideas and always the methods, and then Newton and Leibniz independently discovered essentially modern calculus.
Right. Well, Leibniz definitely discovered it. Yeah, that's what Archimedes did, yeah. We have some, you know, we have the science journal called 21st Century. And we're trying to revive the classical tradition in science, right? Now, LaRouche insists that the way you teach science is throw away the textbooks. Textbooks were a backward step in human civilization. They're all based on Euclid's Elements. You know what Euclid's Elements is? It's this book, supposed book of Greek mathematical discoveries, where it starts out with a list of definitions, axioms, and postulates about geometry. A point has no width, breadth, length, whatever. A line is, you know, an extension with no breadth to it, etc. Surface. Gives you all these definitions, and then it gives you like these axioms, assumptions you're not supposed to question about space. And it's all supposedly based on what you can see. Ultimately, it's all based on what your senses tell you the universe is constructed on. So all these textbooks are based on the same idea, that you start out with a list of definitions, unproven, you know, just stated, axioms, which are assumed, and then postulates, things you can't quite prove, but you want people to assume them anyway. And from there you derive theorems, which are supposed to be true. Right? This is the model for mathematics and science education. Not so much, well, definitely mathematics, absolutely. I can tell you, I was a mathematics major. I looked at one of my old textbooks today, just for fun, give you something here. The fundamental theorem of algebra is dispensed with in one paragraph. This is a tremendous scientific discovery made in 1799 by, well, published in 1799 by Carl Gauss. Greatest mathematician in history, right? How old was he? 22? He was 22 years old when he published this. The first proof that every integral rational function in one variable of the nth degree has at most m roots, but has at least one root, or can be factored into factors of first or second degree. We won't get into a lot of details on that. But basically, that these equations have roots, they're solutions. All right, so he proves this. So this book, which is called Basic Algebra, which is very deceptive, because it's like basic advanced algebra. It says in one paragraph, the so-called fundamental theorem is basically a trivial consequence of the following theorem, blah, blah, blah. And we refer to it as the fundamental theorem only out of respect for the past, because it no longer plays its crucial role in the development of modern algebra. That's how you create very educated dummies. Just telling people that. So anyway, textbooks are designed to keep you from being creative. How would you actually develop the capacity to be a creative scientist? Well, look back in history. People like Gauss, Riemann, Kepler, etc., what did they do? They studied and mastered the original works of the people that made discoveries before them. Boy, what an idea. If you want to learn how to make a discovery, study the discoveries that came before you. Figure out the way Kepler thought. You know, master Gauss's original works. Study Leibniz. Isn't that a revolutionary idea? That's how these people made their discoveries. That's where Leibniz didn't know anything about math when he was 20. Right? And then he became friends with Huygens and these other top scientists. And see, another thing, in his time, he was born, 1642 or something?
46,
yeah, okay. So he's running around Paris in the 1660s. And he's a very gifted law student. And they offered him a professorship, but no, he didn't get a professorship because he was too young. And then some other people offered him a professorship. You know, he traveled around Europe because he wanted to absorb knowledge. All right. And he becomes friends with Huygens. And Huygens he invented the pendulum clock. There's a lot of details that go in about Huygens. But, you know, nothing about mathematics when he was 20. And he invented the calculus, which is recognized as one of the fundamental breakthroughs in the progress of science.
Sorry to interrupt. We gotta be a friend for dinner, but I just wanted to say thanks for letting us stay. That's
come back.
I gotta do some dinner. Hey, Bruce Director will be here.
That market's not so good.
Missiles. And getting a lot of money for defense contractors building these computers that throw rocks at missiles and that kind of thing. So when they came to me, they asked me about it. This is all I said. I said, I'm not worried about Bush knocking out missiles. He can't even keep his daughters from getting bombed. Yeah, the guy on the radio, he said, that's the best joke of the campaign. Are we ready yet?
Yes.
Okay. Well, that's not going to be on the tape, is it? Oh, well. It doesn't have much to do with calculus, does it?
Hey, Bill, you think that's good? Wait till we get it.
Oh, yeah. Something to look forward to.
It's over.
That'll be fun. All right. What's calculus about? What's the main problem we're dealing with in calculus? We're looking at a function. Let's call that a function. We're looking at a curve. Looking at something that's changing relative to something else. Okay? Usually, you know, we have x, y, right? Do you know who first developed the concept of a function? Gottfried Leibniz. Right? So you have a curve that's changing. There's some kind of principle involved in the changing, right? It's most interesting to look at this from the standpoint of functions that actually have some correlation to the actual physical universe, okay? And you mentioned about Archimedes. Now, he actually developed a method for dealing with one of the problems that's addressed in calculus, which is like, you have this curve, and it's changing according to some principle. What's the area under the curve relative to the axis? That's called integral calculus. He figured out how to do it for a parabola. Okay. Now, there's another kind of calculus, or another aspect of it. It's really not separated. It's one unified idea. But there's this idea of how do you determine the rate of change of the curve at a given point in its development? Right? So, figuring out the area under the curve, that's called integral calculus. And if you want to figure out the rate of change, or In other ways, figuring out what the tangent is to a curve, that's differential. But it's all part of the same process. Now the crucial issue here is a new idea, right? I mean, it wasn't just Archimedes. There was, you know, Kepler had figured out methods for calculating the volume of wine casks, right? Fermat figured out the way to calculate the rate of change of different kinds of curves. You know, they had all kinds of different little, you know, special procedures for figuring out different phenomena where the fundamental characteristic was that it changed in a, you know, like at every point of action, there was a change in direction, not something simple like a circle. I mean, that's an interesting problem with Archimedes as well. You know, figuring out the area of a circle or the volume of a sphere. That's also an application of this. I'm not going to go into that right now. But let me just say, I was about to mention about this magazine, okay? We're reviving the classical tradition. This one has a translation of this work by Johann Bernoulli, who was a collaborator of Leibniz. Leibniz and the Bernoulli brothers and Huygens were the guys that really developed the calculus. Leibniz is the first to come up with this fundamental idea. He proved that differential and integral calculus were just two sides of the same coin. And he developed the fundamental idea, which is at the kernel of this method. And that was unique to him.
So you said differential integral calculus?
Yeah.
Is that both of those together?
Differential, no. That's no. Two different aspects.
Oh, okay.
Differential integral. Okay. Another way to think of it is, you know, what happens over, I mean, you apply this not just to areas, but also to the principle of work. Or, in this issue here, they apply it to the idea of this hanging chain. There's one over there.
Yep.
See that tree?
Want it?
No, you can see it, right? This was one of the problems that was of a class that nobody knew how to solve.
There's an eraser right below.
What'd you say?
There's an eraser right in the waste.
Yeah, somebody else can put it up later. See, all right, this chain here assumes this U shape, right? Or this smile. All right. There's a lot of different things you can say about this curve, right? But pretty much the length of the chain and the distance between the points of support is basically what determines the shape of this curve. Oh, one other thing. The universal physical principle of gravity. That's what's determining the shape of this chain. This isn't like a parabola or a circle or something. Well, actually, I shouldn't say that. You know, obviously, this, you know, you blow a bubble, it takes a spherical shape. Why does it take a spherical shape and not the shape of a cube or a chicken? Well, let me tell you something about Leibniz. See, Leibniz was a philosopher mainly, right? Back in his time, the idea of being a philosopher, scientists were known as natural philosophers, right? So, I mean, he thinks of himself in the same tradition as Plato, right? He's trying to discover what are the principles of the universe in every sphere of activity. So in his monadology, which is his basic theory of the universe, he states that, well, there's different levels of development in the universe, and different kinds of individual substances, which he calls monads. They're indestructible. They're not influenced by anything outside of them, but they're the substance of the universe. And we can talk about that more some other time. Animals would be in that category of a monad, and people, and God, we'll get back to that. But the distinguishing characteristic of the monads with minds, humans, is that they can recognize necessary truths, which an animal can't do. I mean, an animal has sense perception, right? An animal, this is why humans can control animals, because they operate on the basis of what their senses tell them. As Leibniz describes, you hit a dog with a stick and hurt him, he's gonna, next time he sees that stick, he's gonna run away. Or, you know, something else equivalent. Because he associates the sensation of getting hit with that stick. Now that's empiricism. Now, you may not know this, but this is how the universities train people to think. This is what television trains people to think. This is what the culture is training, empiricism. If I can't see it, smell it, taste it, have sex with it, whatever, it ain't real. That's empiricism. Now, you said mention about Isaac Newton, right? See, Isaac Newton, right, he's got the credit for, you know, discovering the organization of the solar system. But his motto, which he wrote in his big work, the Principles of Natural Philosophy, Mathematical Principles of Natural Philosophy, he states, I do not make hypotheses. From his standpoint, science is about observing what the senses tell me and coming up with a mathematical description of it. And that's it. He actually says that the idea that objects are attracted to one another by a force that reaches across space to pull them together is a completely absurd, and I don't see how anybody in their right mind would believe it. But that's what his mathematics told him. Or that's what his mathematics says. It's a big fraud. Now, again, so Leibniz says there has to be human beings can recognize necessary truths. And one of those necessary truths is that there's a reason for everything. There's a reason why things are the way they are and not some other way. And a mind can discover what the necessary and sufficient reason for the way things are is. Now there's certain methods of discovering what that is, which I mean, ultimately comes back to this idea that the universe is designed on the basis of what he calls the architectonic principle of construction. The universe is constructed on the principle of fitness, or of the best. All right, now think about that bubble again. Why is it a sphere? It takes that shape because that is a form, a description of it is that it encompasses the greatest volume with the least amount of surface area. It's the most unique form of a three-dimensional figure. Right? Any other shape that it would take would have less volume for the given amount of soap. And that's a principle of least action, right? Or most efficient action. Right? And that's at the basis of, you know, why the wheel is, you know, fundamental basis of, you know, machinery. The wheel, the lever, it's all based on this idea of circular action. And that's the basis of the ancient Greek geometry that we're going to talk about some other time. Now, Leibniz was part of a group of people like Fermat, Huygens, Bernoulli, that applied this principle to science. You know, they said, look, every scientific phenomena or every observed phenomena has a cause, which is a basis of a universal physical principle. So in the case of the catenary, this shape might look like, you know, a parabola, you know, something like a curve of the second power, you know, x squared or something like that. That's what Galileo thought it was, because it really looks like a parabola, right? And this other fellow proved that it wasn't a parabola. But he didn't know what this curve was. He didn't know how you, you know, write a description. Like a parabola would be, like here would be something like this. Y equals x squared. You could have another kind of parabola that was y equals x to the fourth, something like that, right? So this guy, Jungius, proved that it wasn't a parabola. Joachim Jungius. But he didn't know what the curve was. Now there's a whole class of curves that couldn't be described as a simple formula of, you know, x squared, you know, x to the fourth, x cubed, that kind of thing. We're going to get into some of this stuff. We're going to sort of backtrack. But this is an example of the real power of the calculus, right? Because this is a curve that was generated by the universe, right? This isn't some guy drawing a picture, right? The universal physical principle of gravitation makes this shape. Leibniz was the first guy in human history that told you what that shape was. And the calculus enabled him to do that. Now, this translation, this is Bernoulli's method. He published how he did it. I don't think Leibniz ever published how he got that, the result that he did to show what that curve is. He published the fact that he had solved it, and he showed a geometric construction that was pretty astounding for the shape of that curve. But he didn't publish how he did it, but Bernoulli did. In fact, Bernoulli, he wrote up some lectures for this other character named L'Hôpital, who was sort of like a rich amateur mathematician. He gave these lectures in Paris that were based on what Bernoulli wrote up for him. And that's where that comes from. And I have a German translation of those lectures. Now, Bruce Director, who's going to be here next week, right?
Yes.
He's going to be
yes.
here. Right. I mean, he has been taking a major role in educating the youth movement and the history of science and, you know, helping them recreate these scientific discoveries. As LaRouche said, you have to do if you're going to really master science. He said that Bruce's, one of his pedagogical exercises, he describes these lectures by Bernoulli as being the best textbook of calculus ever written. Because it's based on the principles that were used to create the calculus. All right, so I'll make a plug for that. At some point, we're going to have to do this. Right, folks?
Right.
We're going to have to master this chain.
Yeah, yeah.
But let's get started, because there's this fundamental point about how it was developed versus what's taught now. Now, one of my friends, Ernie Shapiro, wrote an article about 6 years ago that was also published in here, and we have copies of it somewhere. Where did I?
Hey, how do you spell that guy's name? Jungius? Joachim?
J-U-N-G.
When was he?
I-U-S. 1600s. Middle 1600s.
How about this guy that we're doing local lectures for?
L'Hôpital.
Like,
yeah, I don't know much about him. But, I mean, all the lectures are written up in Latin. I actually got, they have original copies of it over at MIT. I went there last year to check them out because there were some parts that I couldn't quite figure out in German. Because this stuff was translated in German, and then, there's one set of lectures that was published like 100 years ago in German. And it's kind of weird because this was written in 1697. That's when the stuff was written in Latin. There's one part about differential calculus that didn't get published in German until 1924. It has never been published in English. Never. The best textbook in calculus has never been published in English. And I only know of about four excerpts that exist anywhere that you can get in. It's like 36 lectures on integral calculus. Like, there's like four of them that are available in English that I know of, and three of them are in that magazine.
And you translated it.
Yeah. So we get this. That's my project. That tells you how committed somebody is to keeping people ignorant. They don't want you to know. Why don't they want you to know? Think about that.
All right.
Do some math. I've been sparing you till now. Well, let's look at this. I mean, I said that, you know, the interesting functions have something to do with the real world, right? Okay, what does y equal x squared have to do with? Well, lots of things. How about a square? This side is x, and that side is x. What's the area of the square?
X squared or y.
Yeah, okay. Don't worry about the y yet. X squared, right?
Yeah.
That's the area of this square. Okay. Now, if you if x is 1, then what's the area?
1.
1. Okay. And if x is 2, what's the area?
4.
And if it's 3?
9.
Okay, it's 2.5. All right, sorry. What if it x is 0?
Settle.
Now this isn't really a parabola. To make it look like a parabola.
It's a race, man.
You race. Can I create a permanent grease on you?
I need to get those Clorox wipes.
Oh yeah, there
we go. Get my hand grease off of there. Okay. Okay, if it's 1, then the area is 1, right? If it's 2, then the area is what, 4?
Yeah.
We'll run out of space, right? Alright, if it's 0, it's 0. If 1, it's 1. If 2, it's 4. And if you fill in between, it's going to look something like that, right? So, if you showed this relationship about the square, the relationship of the length of the side to the area of the square, and you call the area y and x, right? This is known as the independent variable, right? Because the y is like an effect of the x. As the length increases or decreases, the area decreases or increases according to the law that's described by this curve. So if you want to describe how this curve moves, how it changes, then you have to figure out how you go from x squared to something else, right? All right, now just listen carefully, right? Because this is the big breakthrough of Leibniz. Wait a minute, I'm getting ahead of myself a little bit. But you've probably seen this before. If I increase the length of the side by, say, a, right? So now the side is what? X plus a. So the area is going to be what? X plus a squared, right? Okay. We can break that down, right? This has got four sections to it. X squared, right? And then you have this rectangle. How long is this?
AX.
X. That's AX.
Yeah,
and this is AX?
2AX.
And what's this?
A squared.
A squared, okay. area of X plus A. All right, well, that tells you something, right? If you're at X, and then you add A to X, then you end up here. So that tells you a little bit something about this function. All right, now here's the breakthrough, I'm sorry. Now, this is where we get to it. You see this relationship. This has been known for thousands of years, right? What do they call that? Binomial?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. So Leibniz says, if you want to understand how this curve changes, instead of having some finite increment of increase in x, he says, well, let's add an infinitely small change to x. Okay, you hear that? Infinitely small. Or he called it infinitesimal. Does that symbol look familiar? Okay. All right, now this is a new idea in mathematics. He's saying that that's the smallest change of increase, or the infinitely small change. So what's the area of this going to be?
The whole thing?
Yep.
Squared.
X squared is 2dx.
You get that that's not d times x, right?
Yeah, it's just 1.
That's a 1. That symbol represents the smallest change of x.
2dx.
2.
Why is it 2x dx?
Is that rectangle? Is x times dx? Mm-hmm.
This is x, this is dx, right?
Oh, yeah, right. Yeah.
And the same thing here. So it's 2x dx. This is dx squared. I could write it in if you want. Over here. Now y is equal to x squared, right? We just changed x by a infinitely small quantity. Right? Smallest possible change of x. So what's going to happen? Is that going to change y? Yeah. And that changes, he called y plus dy. That's the infinitesimal change in y that results from the infinitesimal change in the x.
So there's a corresponding change for a change of x and a change to a change in y. Whenever you change x.
Yeah, we'll look at it over here, right?
Yeah.
See, that's x. And this would be x plus dx. Kind of small there. Right? Now y changes too, right?
Yeah.
It's not the same. So this is going to be, well, this is y over here, and this is going to be y plus dy. Now Leibniz said, okay, well, what we want to look at is, we want to know what this is. We know about y, but what is this thing, right? So he subtracts y from both sides of the equation. Now, I have to admit, I've never seen this represented as Leibniz's method. Well, I've seen it, but I was looking through his works, and I didn't see this written in this way. But this is how Bernoulli does it. And they're on the same page, basically. I mean, they had some disagreements. I just want to say that. But that this is essentially the method. And the main thing is what happens at this point. Because this is where all the fun starts with, you know, the constipated mathematicians. Okay. So I subtract y from this side, and I got dy left, right? Now, on this side, we got everything in x, right? So we're going to subtract x squared, which is the same as y, right? Does that make sense?
No. Say it again.
This is y plus dy. Yes. This is infinitesimal change in y. I want to find this out. I got to subtract y from this side. And I got to subtract y from this side. Right? That makes sense?
Because y
equals x squared. So if I subtract x squared from this side of the equation, then what's left is equal to this.
So dy equals dx.
So dy equals 2x dx. Plus dx squared. Okay. All right, now this is the fun part here. All right, now the way Bernoulli has it in his representation, he has a list of rules for calculation where he says that if you add an infinitesimal to a finite quantity, basically, it doesn't change the finite quantity. And the other thing is, if you raise it, see, he's looking at different levels of change as well. Now, at this step in the equation, this dx squared disappears. Now, think about it from the standpoint of this square up here.
Wait, you just said dx squared disappears?
Yeah. Okay. What he wants to show is the relationship of the change in y that is caused by the change in the x. Now, if you think about this square here, now, in reality, this would be an infinitesimal thin rectangle, right? And this would be another one. And this would be an infinitesimal square. Okay.
Okay.
And from his standpoint, that basically is zero with respect to this. He identifies something called the principle of continuity. This is important. See, Leibniz is trying to figure out mathematics that corresponds to the actual universe. Okay? He's not interested in constructing a theorem lattice of axioms and postulates. He wants to get at what's really going on in the universe. Okay? Now, one of the principles which he identifies as an architectonic principle of the universe is this principle of continuity. Now, here's an example of one of the things he says about it. If in a given series one value approaches another value continuously and at length disappears into it, the results dependent on these values in the unknown series must also necessarily approach each other continuously, and at length end in each other. So in geometry, for example, the case of an ellipse continuously approaches that of a parabola, as one focus remains fixed and the other is moved farther and farther away until the ellipse goes over into a parabola where the focus is removed infinitely. Therefore, all the rules for the ellipse must of necessity be verified in the parabola, understood as an ellipse whose second focus is at an infinite distance. This reminds me, I forgot to bring the flashlight to show you this. It's in the other room. You want to get it? Hence, rays striking a parabola in parallel lines can be conceived as coming from the other focus or tending toward it. Hence, rays striking a parabola in parallel lines can be conceived as coming from the other focus or tending towards it. Rather than draw ellipses and parabolas, if you want to use the flashlight to show you something.
Wait, he said rays that are striking the parabola in parallel lines are coming from the ellipse, or the foci infinitely far away.
All right. So yeah, if you have an ellipse, right? It's got two foci, right? Looks something like that. He's saying that as this focus moves out further, the ellipse is being transformed continuously. It's going to be a flatter ellipse and a flatter ellipse, and then eventually it's going to switch over to a parabola, which can be conceived of as an ellipse that's infinite on one side, right?
It doesn't expand when you pull it out?
Well, let's see what happens.
I feel it expands.
Well, it depends on how you change it. This is kind of weird. See an ellipse in there?
Yep.
Is that clear? Okay. Like, look at that ellipse. Right? As I move it, well, it's getting kind of faint, isn't it? You see the ellipse is getting stretching out, flatter? Okay. Now. Hope I'm not attracting attention out there. At a certain angle, what's going on is the ellipse is turning into a parabola, right? Which, like he says, could be treated as an ellipse where one of the foci is infinitely distant. Mm-hmm. Now, the thing, one of the characteristics of an ellipse is that the distance from one focus to the ellipse, you know, these two distances, right, from the foci, that they add up, they're a constant, right? So, or you could look at it this way, that if you project a light ray from this focus, it's going to hit the surface of the ellipse and bounce back and hit the other focus, right? But if the focus were infinitely far away, then it's not going to, then if you go like that, it's going to go parallel. That's what he's saying.
Oh, wow.
Okay. Like a parabolic light thingy. What do you call it?
Headlight.
Headlight, yeah.
That's what I need. All right.
Okay. But his point is that this is a physical principle of continuity. That if the causes converge, then the effects should converge.
All right.
So this dx thing, this dx squared is going to disappear. Now this dx squared comes back with a vengeance later, so don't worry about it. If it bothers you that this disappears.
Wait, what's that now? About disappearing.
I knew it bothered.
That's what bothers constipated mathematicians. Is that what you said?
No, they don't. They have their sneaky way around this.
All right, I thought you were calling me complicated math.
No.
They don't wonder about that.
No, this is an important question. It's something to think about.
Wait, are you about to start talking about dy then? Because I'm confused about dy.
Well, dy equals this.
Yeah.
The question is, what does this mean? Now he thinks of it sort of as like a hierarchy.
But isn't dy also in the same? Shouldn't you be thinking of dy kind of like you're thinking of this whole dx squared thing also?
Think about it this way, all right? This is a finite quantity, right? Mm-hmm. So the square is a finite quantity. Okay? Now this is a finite quantity times an infinitesimal quantity, all right? Now from Leibniz and Bernoulli standpoint, that's an infinitesimal rectangle, okay? And so is this one. Alright, and then we get to this one here. This is an infinitesimal squared. Okay?
Yeah.
And think, what if you have one hundredth of something, right, and then you square it, what do you get? You get 1/10,000th of something. Right? It's a lot smaller. Right? Now, in their representation here, the higher powers of this dx relative to the first differential. This is like a, this is a diff. Okay. This is infinitely smaller than this infinitely small rectangle.
Wow. Yeah, that makes sense.
Give it some thought. That makes sense. So that's why he gets rid of it. So what he's left with is dy equals 2x dx. So the infinitesimal change in x results in an infinitesimal change in dy,
yeah,
which is proportional to 2x.
You go over that again. Would you,
all right.
Every time we get here.
Hmm?
Every time we get to that part,
that's funny.
I don't get confused. It's just this continuity.
Well, this is a new idea. This is a revolution in science. So it should take some thought. It shouldn't be glossed over. See, this is what this is what you don't hear about.
Right.
Well, I mean, I should actually read what these mathematicians say about this now. We've all been indoctrinated that this is mystical, metaphysical garbage. You know, I mean, you remember when Phil, he read these quotes from Courant, the mathematician? I actually have some other quotes from Courant. They're not the same ones, right? They're a bit nasty. But I remember one thing he said was that, you know, these guys, Bernoulli and Leibniz, you know, they invented calculus and they were all over the place. They were kind of wild. They weren't rigorous, but they came up with all these new methods that worked extremely well because they knew what they were doing, right? But fortunately, 100 years later, a bunch of other guys came on and put the brakes on and said, hey, wait a minute, we got to be rigorous. And then he says, it's a good thing they didn't show up earlier because it would have stopped the progress of mathematics. You remember that quote?
Yeah.
That's from this textbook that Courant wrote. This is another book, Elementary Approach to Ideas and Methods. What is mathematics? This is for the masses, okay? This is not for the indoctrinated, brainwashed elite, okay?
What did you say? That's for the what?
This is for the masses.
Oh.
You know, people who don't want to be mathematicians, but they like to know something about mathematics, right? Oh. So it's a popular version.
Oh, not the brainwashed. So if you're part of the elite, it means you get to get rigorously brainwashed?
You get the real tough, you know, pounding. This is so you sort of get an idea, a flavor of things. But look, let's get back to what...
Hey,
what
so you're saying, what Valente asked you, you're saying that, this is where I went off to, you said you're trying to show the relationship between the change in Y that's caused by the change in X.
Right.
And that's what this thing is here?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
All right, let's see. Think about this, all right? Well, first look at this, right? And you can see that as X gets larger and larger, these infinitesimal strips that make x squared get larger, they get larger too, don't they? Right? In one dimension, it's just dx, but these strips get longer and longer, right? And how long do they get? On this side, it gets proportional to x, and on this side, it's proportional to x. So the bigger this square gets, the bigger the infinitesimal increase gets as you get it bigger.
But they're all infinitesimally small.
Yes.
And then the bigger the little square is.
But the issue is the proportion between the change in x and the change in y.
Oh. Is the little square then going to get even smaller, the bigger it gets?
All right, let me give you a crude geometrical example.
I see.
Okay, this is kind of... Say hypothetically, you have two people. Say you have two people. One of them weighs 100 pounds. The other one weighs 300 pounds. Okay? Now, if the person that weighs 100 pounds gains 5 pounds, they look a lot different, don't they? Whereas the person that weighs 300 pounds, this is... I have personal experience with this. They gain 5 pounds, nobody notices. Because it's such a small percentage of increase. Right? Okay, nasty comments.
I noticed you lost a little bit of weight.
Well, thank you. But, all right, anyway. But the camera's going to put it back.
Jerry's still
kind of... No, I'm serious.
So this here... Hey, come on. Sorry. Right. Among friends, right? Okay. So this rectangle, it we'll say I put it up here, right?
But wait, the bigger the infinitesimal rectangles get, the smaller the infinitesimal square gets.
Well, it's about the same.
It's about the same?
It's about the same. Get rid of that. Okay, so now, let's add the infinitesimal to this square, right? So now, the strip of increase is going to be that big, and on this side, it's that big. You see?
I see it.
And then you get that. If I had made this dx equal, then this square would be exactly equal to that, right? But you see how the increase, I should do it that way. It's going to be confusing.
That's cool.
Add dx to this. It's the same size. Right? Now that rectangle is definitely bigger. That rectangle is definitely bigger than this one, right? Can you see that? So this represents it was x dx down here, right? Well, this is the bigger x, so let's call it x prime, okay? We call this x prime dx. And this is x dx. Now, x prime is bigger than x, right? Yes? This length?
Yeah.
So the infinitesimal change in the area is going to be bigger. See that as it gets bigger, the rate of increase increases. Okay. All right. Now he called this, huh?
Can you say that last thing one more time?
As x increases, the rate of increase increases. The rate of increase of y with respect to this x, as x gets bigger, y gets bigger in proportion to the size of x times 2. Now if you go on this graph here, there's this thing that Leibniz called a characteristic triangle. Not curvy enough. Call this thing the characteristic triangle. If you're at this point here, this is the change in x. Well, you have to think of like a tangent going through here. Kind of hard for me to draw it, and it's not curved enough.
Maybe the ruler or something.
Is this somebody's contact here?
He doesn't seem to be here. We can put him in. All
right. That's supposed to be a tangent to this curve, right? In other words, it could be thought of as like the line that intersects this curve at exactly one point. But really think about it in terms of the change. Remember what I said about the universe being made of work? This is kind of important, okay? This is the difference between Leibniz and Cauchy. We're getting to it right now. This triangle, this is a right triangle. The base is dx, and this thing here is dy. It should look like a right triangle. And he calls it the characteristic triangle. Because at that point, the way that y changes caused by x changing is proportional to the slope of that line there. That may look familiar if you've taken calculus before. But see, here's the difference here. Leibniz insists on calling this an infinitesimal change, right? Or he calls it the last value. Now, this is what I think he's getting at here. And let me get philosophical here, because this is philosophy, right? And mathematicians don't want philosophy mucking around in their mathematics, right? Some of them don't want physics mucking around in their mathematics. Right. Now, this is not to say that that a physicist who's interested in discovering something can't use this, right? But to the degree that you, well, put it this way, the way people are taught calculus today, and for the last 100 years, and for 200 years they've been teaching this Cauchy business, basically. No, not quite. Maybe 150 years, something like that. Cauchy was born in 1789, so it wasn't quite 200 years. What's going on here from the standpoint of Leibniz is he's interested in what's causing this change. That there's some principle acting that makes this curve change direction. You know, at every interval of its action, right? Every point of its action. And you could think of it in a certain way that there's a spirit in this curve. There's an intention represented by this curve. It's much more explicit when you're dealing with the catenary, because you know that there's a physical, universal physical principle acting that makes this curve take this shape. Right? See? Why is the curve taking the shape that it has? Well, Leibniz's idea here would point you to the method to figure that out. Can you see that? Is my arm in the way? Some of you can see.
Yeah, it's pretty visible. Oh, it's just one of those.
What's the intention that makes the curve move the way it does? Or what's the physical principle? What's the quantification of that principle? Right? Now for this curve, it's 2x dx. I'd like to do one more example before we stop. One that I can show you physically. Remember, this is just a warm-up till we get to the catenary. It sort of gives you an idea of what this is about. I wish I had bigger blocks here. All right. What do you think I'm going to write up there next? This is a cube. Can you get that on the camera? Is it too low? Well, maybe you might want to, those who can move up closer.
Now we're going to have y equals x cubed.
Well, that's okay.
All right. Now this is x. This is the side of this is x, right? So what's the volume of that cube? Are you sure? Okay, good. All right, what do you think I'm going to do next?
Yeah. Oh, I can't stop thinking about the parent graph.
Now, how would this grow?
Two ways at the same time.
This one grew a strip here and a strip there in an infinitesimal square. Okay? So it's like two directions of growth, right? Now this is a cube. How many dimensions are we talking about?
Three.
How many degrees of growth?
Three.
Three. Okay. Now, there's something funny that happens here. Okay, now, so it's going to grow like out this way, and out that way, and out that way, right? You're going to be able to see it?
I can try it.
Put it what?
Just stack the blocks.
Oh, so it's higher up. I see.
Okay.
All right, so you can see the cube is going to grow by this square surface here, right? It's going to be like a little box growing out the side. And then another one here. And then another one here, right? See?
Well, that one's too lopsided.
But there's more.
Yeah.
What about here? So it grows by a square box here, and a square box here, and a square box here. And then we have another little box that goes here. Because remember, we're going to the next cube, right? And another little box there. And another little box here.
Those are all the X, DXs, right?
Well, yeah. We didn't make them DXs yet.
That's what they stand for. Yeah.
I forgot. Careful. Blocking on the blocks. One more. And voila, I have the next cube. So the volume of the first cube is x squared, x cubed, right? Okay. Now, if that block is say A, then it's going to be x plus A cubed, right? Is that right?
Yeah.
Now, we can make it the infinitesimal, since you know that's where we're going, right? So, x plus dx. Now we're cubing it, multiplying it by itself three times.
Wait, that's just y times a, right?
Not like y.
Hmm? What's that? Right under y equals x.
That's
cubed.
The y if you add a. That's all I meant by that.
Y plus a?
No, you added a to x. If a is
all right,
finite. Yeah. That's just so it looks different from this one.
Okay.
All right. Now what goes over here?
dy.
Usually they put the dy after, so I should probably do that. Okay, so now for this relationship of the side to the volume. If I have an infinitesimal increase in the edge, the length of the edge, I multiply the edge by itself three times, right? To get the quantity for the volume. All right, so I add a little bit, so I have to multiply this by itself three times. Now what does this come out to? Well, it comes out to this.
Oh. Where did the 3 come from?
Well, see that? This is 3x squared. I mean, this is x squared times dx, right?
Yeah.
That's x squared, and then this is the dx. Mm-hmm. Right? Then I got Excuse me, I took too many of them off. I'm sorry. Let me put this back here. I need more blocks. I have to get my granddaughter's permission. What I meant to say is, all right, this here is x squared. See, this is x squared, and then this is dx. Right? So I have one of those. And I can't really take this one off without holding these, right? Then I have another one, right?
But that, those two there are dx?
This is x squared times dx.
Oh. Squared
what? This has to stay up here, though. And then I have to take it from the other side, and I'm running out of hands. But you can see that I got three of these. Three of these, and then I got three of these.
No.
This is 3x dx squared.
You gotta take a block away.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, there you go.
So
yeah.
This is x, say this is. This is x. This is dx, and this is dx.
Ah.
So this is x times dx squared.
Species? Power?
Thank you, thank you. Different power. Square. Different power from the cube. Or the line that generates the square is different from the line that generates the cube. Different power. Okay, so you get all this. Now if we apply the same reasoning that we had before, what happens? We want to know what dy is, right? So what do we subtract? Y from this side, and we subtract what from this side?
X cubed,
which is the same as y, right? So then we have dy equals 3x squared dx plus 3x dx squared plus dx cubed. Now that's infinitely smaller than that, isn't it?
Yes.
So it definitely doesn't belong here, right?
No.
According to that principle.
Mm-hmm.
We'll get back to those, though. Well, it gets pretty hard if you do the cubes. All right, now what about this? That's infinitely smaller than that, isn't it? That's a second power of this dx. Is that okay, Matt? Is that all right?
Oh, man, I don't know.
I have to get rid of the act. Well,
what'd you say, Bill?
This here, this is finite, right? 3x squared?
Yes.
And this is infinitesimal.
Yes.
Right.
Okay, now this is 3x. That's finite, right?
Right.
And this is infinitesimal
squared.
So this would be infinitely smaller than that.
So we gotta get rid of that one too?
Yep.
Oh, shit.
Well, don't worry. See, if you had an equation that was all second powers of dx, then it's a different ballgame. We'll come to that.
Hey, didn't you just give dy now two different values?
No.
Because before it was dy was 2x dx.
Yeah, but y was a different function.
Y squared.
Yeah, that was y squared. Oh, yeah.
I should have used a different symbol. I'm sorry. If y is x cubed, then everything changes. So now we got dy equals 3x squared dx. You see a pattern here?
Coefficients. Nope.
else too, Bill?
What?
Oh, never mind.
Are you okay with those infinites canceling out?
Intestinals canceling out?
We're
gonna figure it out later.
Am I okay with that?
Yeah.
Well, I have to, I'm kind of struggling with this.
It seems to me kind of like that if they're saying that infinite polygon.
You mean a polygon with an infinite number of infinitely small sides?
Isn't it Cauchy?
No. Bernoulli actually says that a curve could be treated as a is made up of infinitely many infinitely small lines. Is he?
No, I'm not.
Wait, you serious, Bill?
I take it back.
Yeah. You want me to read it?
It's in the small line.
Sure. Why not?
I got it.
Who said he's lying?
See, but the idea of infinitely small lines changes you. It's not a line as you think of it. So I don't know what that means, but it's not a line by right. Line.
Well, see, he did have a little of this Euclid thing in him. When he starts his lectures on the differential calculus, he says a magnitude, number one, a magnitude which is decreased or increased by an infinitely small magnitude is neither increased nor decreased. Number two, he says every curved line consists of infinitely many straight lines which themselves are infinitely small. Then there's another one that's not really relevant.
Can you read number two one more time, Bill? I'm sorry.
Every curved line consists of infinitely many straight lines, which themselves are infinitely small.
But then,
what'd you say?
He must have a different idea what a straight line is. He's saying.
Well, when you say an infinitely small line, it just changes the whole thing.
But that's what I'm saying.
What's an infinitely small line? This is dx, isn't it? It's a new idea, isn't it?
Totally not.
This is a new idea. It's a new thought object.
He gets a new idea and then he just cracks it up.
Squared it. Yes. Well, see, one way that I like to put it is, if you want to understand Leibniz's calculus, you have to be a philosopher.
That's okay.
As opposed to Cauchy.
That's true.
They have a nice way of getting rid of this problem. But it's all based on empiricism. Now, wait a minute. Think about the curve, okay? What is the curve? Is the curve a sense object? Is the curve, or is the curve the footprint of a process?
The last one's pretty. The last one's more tracking.
Well, didn't you say the curve came out of the idea of a function?
Mm-hmm.
And where the heck did that idea come from?
Well, there you go. What caused the curve?
A function?
Is the curve a sense object, or is it?
It's work. Function.
All right.
Oh, man.
It represents something that's changing, right? Well, what does it represent? Oh, the cube, right, or the square? There's a process of change going on. How can we measure that? How can we quantify that? You think of the straight. You think of the infinitely small straight line as a different idea from the side of a polygon. Can you get that concept? I don't know. Think about it. What does this represent? Why is this a new thought object? Now with the catenary, it's much more of a stunning thing, but it's more work. Okay, so we'll have to get into it. But this is sort of like get you started. Right? The reason is because the catenary is generated by this universal physical principle of gravity. Right? and it's part, it's a class of curve called transcendental. It's not like these, like x squared, x cubed, those are algebraic. You can guess why that would be called algebraic, right?
Bill, did he work on this stuff with the dynamics thing, the dynamics stuff, about objects falling at the square of their distance?
Well, I'm sure he applied it to that. One thing to think about also, in a physical process, what's going on? What's causing the change? And is the change smooth? Is it linear? Now this gets to this Cauchy business. Time business. Oh, a few minutes before it gets ridiculous, right? Okay. Now, all right, let me show you what Cauchy says about this. I have to do it quick. I don't know if Cauchy wrote it exactly this way, but this is what they, this is what you'll get if you take calculus in college. If you take the kind of calculus where they want you to be a mathematician. Well, Phil told you about this, right?
Except he didn't do all that. He just drew a little line.
Yeah.
You just drew a line?
Yeah, a small curve. Drew a circle, and then he drew a little line, and then it went off. I got him to give him a better mind.
Phil has a better idea what's important than me. Because he didn't get brainwashed, okay? Okay, now what does that mean? No. See, if that DX thing bothers you, now you have a... I wrote it a little different. Now let's just say, we'll call y f of x, f function x. I'm just going to call it that. Okay. Now, this fx minus fx sub 0 equals, well, that's a change in y. And he calls it delta y.
That big thing equals change in x, y over a change in x?
I need to write that limit. It's getting nasty over here.
What's getting nasty?
There's all this stuff up here. Now see, here's what they do, all right? This is, say this is the initial value. You're trying to figure out what the derivative is at this point, okay? All right, now the derivative is basically the ratio of the two differentials, okay? We call it differential ratio. You see this here? This is a finite change in x, right?
Yes.
This is x and x zero. That's a finite idea. It's not infinitesimal. It gets real close. And this is f of x and f of x zero. So they get close, but it's all finite. So this is a finite quantity and that's a finite quantity. Now this thing means limit. That means that as x gets closer to x0, this whole expression gets closer and closer and closer to something else. All right? And that thing that it gets closer to, it's called the limit. it's like this. Say this is, call this x0, right? And we'll call this, no. Let's approach it this way, all right? Oh, that's not what I meant. All right, say this is x, right? So now you have, now this is a finite triangle. Excuse me, this should be y0, right? So draw my graph on here. So you have a finite change, right? And a finite change here. This is, she's on the other side. That's y, and then up here is y sub zero. So the length of this is y minus y sub zero. See that? That's a finite triangle. That's not an infinitesimal triangle. And this limit thing means that, okay, so that's pretty close, but what do you get? You got a line that cuts across these two points, right? Now, then they say, well, let's pick another point. Let's say x prime.
Wait a second. Why are you subtracting y sub zero from point y, which is,
well, it just means they're different
at the bottom. Or is that y not, well, not at the bottom?
This is y up here.
You know what I'm saying in your picture?
No, this
the is y is not the bottom of the graph, is it?
No, yeah.
Is it?
Well, say this is zero here. Doesn't really matter.
Well, that's what I'm saying. How can you subtract? How can you have y minus y sub zero from y is like at the 0 point? Wouldn't that be zero minus whatever?
No, the main thing is it's a finite difference. That as you go over, this thing goes up, right? That happens all the way over the curve, right? But the fundamental thing here, maybe I should draw another picture. Would that help?
No,
is it too small?
It's not the
picture. Are you sure it's not y sub 0 minus y?
Doesn't really matter. The main thing is the difference.
Okay.
That there's a difference between them.
And I'm also wondering, you have a limit x change to x sub 0.
Mm-hmm.
Now you're talking about y. Oh, I guess you're drawing another.
Yeah. It's just, see, look, the basic idea is that as this x gets closer to x0, then this f of x is getting closer to this fx0. Okay? It doesn't sound that much different from Leibniz. But here's the difference. From the standpoint of Cauchy, and they're very explicit about this, this idea, this intuitive idea, as they call it, of continuity, right, which happens to correspond to this principle of continuity that Leibniz is talking about. So that's a fiction of the human mind. As scientists, all we can go by is what we can observe. All we're going to see is a set of x's and a set of y's, right? And all we can say is, as the x's, as we get all these discrete data points that we can see, of x getting closer and closer to x0, we're going to see the function, the results, the y's are going to get closer and closer together. So basically what they're doing is they're taking an average that's getting closer and closer to that y. They're doing exactly the same thing that Chase Econometrics and the Wharton School and Data Resources did in this graph. See that curve again? See, they're saying, oh, well, it's going this way at this rate, and this is going to keep going, right? It's all linear. Nothing's changing. It's all wonderful. See? And what is this? Well, this is just doing it in the small. This is just saying, well, basically, nothing really much going on here. We got my nice empiricist data points. And we're getting closer and closer to this x, so let's take the average, and we're going to say that's what's happening.
Oh, so you say, okay, so they're saying we're going to take the average of x, and that's going to automatically affect this other thing, like the top part?
No, he's saying that there's we got these x data points, and we got these y data points. Okay. That's all we can see. And all we are interested in is what we can see. Okay. What's observable? I should read the quote.
I don't see how it's different from libraries, but read a quote first.
Okay. Oh, I like all these nice attacks on libraries. Well, I should read some of those attacks first, because he invented it, right? Cauchy's coming along 100 years later. First of all, he talks about how Newton and Leibniz both invented the calculus, and they didn't really invent it anyway. It was just they're just the end product of a long series of evolution. It didn't start with them and it didn't end with them, but they were decisive. Blah, 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 right? And then he says there's two problems, the problem of tangents and the problems of quadrature, you know, to get the area of the curve. And then he said Newton and Leibniz, they were the first to recognize that the quadrature problem and the tangent problem were two sides of the same coin. Okay, anyway, all right. Then it says, much of the success was due to the marvelous symbolic notation invented by Leibniz. You may have heard that. Leibniz invented this notation as dy dx, which everybody uses. Now here's the next part. His achievement is in no way diminished by the fact that it was linked with hazy and untenable ideas, which are apt to perpetuate a lack of precise understanding in minds that prefer mysticism to clarity. In other words, Leibniz is a philosopher, and nobody can understand what he's doing. But he invented the calculus, so. Anyways. And plus, everybody Newton supposedly, they say he invented it, right? But there's no real evidence of that. The evidence that the guy was trying to figure out black magic and witchcraft and alchemy. And you know they tried to like put him up as like the straw man opposition to Leibniz, not just in math but in physics too.
Hey, why is it that is there any like why do they say he invented the calculus?
Because they would rather you be a black magic alchemy expert than a Leibniz.
I'm just saying. So you're saying they actually have there's no like Newton's formulas about calculus.
They don't want you to know how Leibniz thought. That's why Bruce said this is the best textbook in calculus ever written. And it still doesn't exist in English.
I think just one
308 years later. But
no, I was just gonna say, I mean just the basic method around that time was the Venetian method, right? We've made these breakthroughs, but the way we're gonna teach it is from the standpoint of formalism, so you can know the formalism, but not the actual breakthrough.
That's the point I was trying to make about the textbook. See, the mathematics textbook is written to smooth out all the discoveries. You're supposed to believe that all of the results in the book are derived from the axioms that they put in the first chapter. Right? I mean, they might attach a name to a theorem. Right? But the thing they do is the axioms that you would need, or the postulates that you would need to prove the theorems that are in the book. The theorems may or may not correspond to an actual discovery, like the fundamental theorem, something like that. But the way it's presented is that it's just a simple consequence of this elaborate set of postulates that we're throwing at you and telling you to learn. Sometimes they give you some plausible description or explanation. But most of the time, it's just this, you know, this elaborate system you're supposed to to learn. But the main thing is to smooth over the discoveries. It's just like the actual calculation. You got all these empiricist data points, and you take an average, and assuming that nothing is changing in the infinitely small. First of all, the curve has to be there already, right? Well, what's making the change happen? You see the difference? It's kind of subtle, but it's absolutely decisive. I mean, you know, relative to the universe, an individual person is very, 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 very tiny, right? But that one individual has the power to change the universal law, doesn't it? Well, it can discover a principle and then apply the principle, you know, in collaboration with the other ones, and transform the laws of the universe. You can create states of matter and physical processes that never existed before in the history of the universe. That's what that infinitesimal human being can do, right? And, you know, this may seem like a stretching analogy, but this is the essence of Leibniz. This curve here, the change that is that this the physical principle that generates the curve has a principle of change that you can describe in terms of these infinitesimals. That's why I kept saying that the change in X results in the change in Y.
But you're saying you can't know the principle.
Well, you can come up with a mathematical description. If you use this method and this method, you get the same answer. Except what's the question? Now, if you're an empiricist, if you're Newton or Maxwell, right, or Cauchy, you're not looking for universal principle. You're looking for a mathematical description of nature. Do you see the difference?
It's kind of right now.
Well,
this way. I'm a little bit confused by that thing up there.
Which one?
Maybe if you could go through that, you're saying that's there.
This thing?
That thing is the description, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm wondering.
It gets even worse. It gets worse. But let me read.
Are you saying this stuff about where Bernoulli was, like, kept taking out the differential? That's what I'm wondering about, like, what, how that has to do with the idea? Because it doesn't, I don't know, it doesn't seem that profound to me. But, yeah, I don't know.
What do you mean, doesn't seem profound?
I mean, I'm just unclear about how this is talking about this idea that you're saying that this infinitesimal creates the end product.
Yeah.
Dy equals this. The mm-hmm. infinitesimal changes are creating
yeah.
that end product.
Yeah.
And up here, I'm starting, I'm confused what the hell that limit thing is. You're saying those are the two different systems, right?
Yeah. Well, this was the invention of the calculus. And that is the empiricist representation that's used to brainwash people.
Are you saying that, so the infinitesimal changes are things that are seemingly invisible, but they're representing a principle of change?
Let me throw something out
okay.
to you. One thing. Again, this question of what's the universe made of? And let's sort of get in between Leibniz and Cauchy and look at what Euler said. Are you familiar with Euler's refutation of the monadology?
No.
Not familiar with that. It's in the
said,
Science of Christian Economy.
You got to refresh my memory.
All right.
He said didn't he say there's always going to be something smaller and smaller and smaller?
Yeah, he's saying the universe is infinitely divisible.
Yeah.
Because that's what his senses is telling him. He has this simple demonstration. He says that, let's see, something like this. Somebody should get the book. I think I've got it.
Yeah, that's it.
The direction.
That's basically it, right there.
Yeah, he's saying, this straight line here, I can divide it up infinitely small. You know, I just, something like this. If I divide this one up into so many points and then project down here, then I can divide that line up as much as I want, and there's no limit to it.
You could always make a bigger line above it, divide it smaller.
Yeah, but the name he's dividing this line up infinitely fine. There's no limit to it. You just keep dividing.
All right.
Now, that's what sense certainty tells you about space, right? But what about physics? What about the actual universe? Is it infinitely divisible like that? Is a physical process infinitely divisible that way?
Yeah.
It is?
Can you ask that question again?
Is the universe infinitely divisible?
You said it's a physical process?
Yeah. Like if you were doing a curve representing population change, right? What is dx? Is there a dx or is it just the average?
The discoveries that take place. Right?
No, I'm talking about like a population curve. Like you just want to look at a curve of growth of population. Is there a quantum of least action? What happens if x and x zero are the difference is one half of a person?
What?
It's your average.
Okay. This is kind of stupid.
Yeah. I can see that.
You're putting yourself down in a trap.
All right. And say the population grows by, some population you're looking at. Say it grows by 730 over the course of a year. Okay? Now, if you apply this kind of reasoning, right, divide the year up into 365 days, right? Does that mean that there's some day when there's half a person born or half a person dies? Mm-hmm. Is that possible? Something to think about. Now look, look at what we think we know about matter, right? Now, if you look at a lump of salt, right? What's the salt made of?
Sodium.
Made up of? No, not just sodium.
Chlorine.
Well, what's it called? It's a physical. It's a compound, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's a sodium and chlorine, right? Bound together, right? Now, what happens when they split? They're not together, then they're not sodium,
not
chloride.
It's not a compound.
It's not a compound. Then you're looking at sodium and chloride. Right? Now, if you go look at the sodium, if you look down further, then you have an atom, right, that has, I forget the atomic number, right, certain number of protons and neutrons and electrons, right? Now, is that sodium?
No.
No. It's a sodium atom, right? It's got the neutrons and whatever the hell else is there, right?
Yeah.
Now, what does that tell you about the universe?
There's moving.
Yes.
There's unities involved, right? Which are indivisible, or at least if you divide them, you're not looking at the same thing anymore.
I don't think they're physical, though.
Oh.
They're not physical? What are they?
I know, that's cool. Can you say that one more time?
I said, if you divide them, they're not the same thing.
All right.
You're looking at something completely different. Or I like, way back when, Phil used to use this example. He's talking about what's wrong with physics. Because he said that, because the way they investigate all these subatomic particles is they spin them around in a cyclotron or a linear accelerator at 99% of the speed of light and smash them into one another. And then all these things fly out, and then they count what they are. You know, they follow the trails that they leave in the cloud chamber, right, or the bubble chamber, or whatever the hell else they use. And they can find the trail, and they can figure out, oh, there's a new particle. Here's a new particle. And they got all these different particles, right, from smashing these things together. So how did that get interpreted? Oh, well, these things are inside the particle. You just have to smash them to get them out. And he said, I said, but wait a minute. What if you want to understand how a cow is put together, do you drop an atomic bomb on it? You're going to get all kinds of interesting things that pop out. Is that going to be a cow? Is that going to tell you what a cow is?
Yeah.
I mean, there's a certain principle involved. I mean, and this sort of gets to this uncertainty principle in the quantum physics, right? Because they have this whole thing that you can't know the position and the momentum of a particle to, you know, arbitrary accuracy. You can know one. If you know one, then the other is fuzzy, or vice versa. You can know the momentum, but then you don't know the position. If you know the position, then you don't know the momentum. You ever heard of that?
Yeah.
Called the Heisenberg uncertainty principle?
That's what that is.
All right. Now, you can look at it two ways. You can say, well, that means that I can't intervene in the microphysical realm without changing something. So I'm trying to figure out what is the lawfulness of the change that I create when I do something, right? Or you could take it from the standpoint of Niels Bohr and people like him, and you can say, we can't know the momentum and the position of the particle. Therefore, these concepts are meaningless. We can only have a certain quantum knowledge. All right, now, I mean, you know, there's all kinds of stuff that's got to get figured out. But, I mean, they got this whole thing about how, you know, like Schrodinger's cat, you ever hear that one?
No.
There's a radioactive piece of something that's attached to this. There's a box with a cat in it, right? And there's a lock on the box. No, there's a vial of poison gas in there with the cat. And the latch on the poison gas is connected to like a Geiger counter or something. And then there's some particle, some radioactive substance or something. It's got a particle that's either going to decay or it doesn't decay. And if it decays, it's going to hit the sensor, the Geiger counter, is going to open the poison gas and kill the cat. All right? Now, if the quantum probability of that particle decaying in a given period of time is 50%, then you would say there's a 50-50 chance that the cat is dead or alive, right? Right? But when you open the box, the cat's going to be dead or alive, right? But they say you really can't ask the question until you open the box. If you don't open the box, you don't know whether the cat is alive or dead. And and the cat isn't alive or dead. It's 50% dead or 50% alive. Something like that.
You can never know anything.
Yeah. Okay. Now, I mentioned this quantum business because think about this. If we don't have time to go through it, but see, Newton's gravitational theory, right, this business about force, etc. The planets are moving around the sun because of this force of gravity pulling it. It has absolutely nothing to say about why those planets are in those orbits. It only describes what the force would be if that's what's actually making them go around the sun.
Hey, wait, can you say that one again?
Newton's laws don't explain why the planets are in the orbits they're in. Now, obviously, we've studied Kepler, right? And he described that the planets are moving in ellipses, right? They sweep out equal areas at equal times. And there's a relationship between the orbital period, I think it's the orbital period cubed over the, no, squared over the average radius cube, something like that.
Right. Time cube.
It's one of them. I keep forgetting. All right, but see, Kepler didn't think that was all that important. It's a discovery. But what was he getting at? Why are the planets organized the way they are, right? And then he develops the idea of the musical harmony, right? Because he's trying to get at, well, how did the solar system get created the way it is? Now, if you take these three Kepler laws of planetary motion, he never called them that, right? He just discovered it, right? He also has a part in The New Astronomy where he describes that if you had two objects off by themselves with nothing else acting on them, that they'd be attracted to one another with a force proportional to the distance. That's supposed to be Leibniz, Newton's great discovery. But Newton has it in there. He just didn't think that was such a big deal, because that's not what he's asking. He's asking, how's the universe composed?
You mean Kepler had it in there?
I mean Kepler, yeah. Kepler had it in there. But that's supposed to be Newton's great discovery. Right? Kepler's, he's answering a different question. He's saying, how did the universe get constructed? He's saying God constructed the universe on rational principles that I can comprehend. Right? And that's why he comes up with this idea of musical harmony to describe the planets. And that's how he knows that there is this exploded planet or something between Mars and Jupiter. He had never seen it. Nobody had ever seen it, right? But he said it had to be there. And then Gauss comes along, 150 years later, and proves that there's an exploded planet in between Mars and Jupiter. Now, does Newton have anything to say about that?
Well,
no, he doesn't. In fact, using his method, what he has to do is explain how the action at a distance force of all the planets act on each other and the sun, and it's called like a three-body problem or an n-body problem, and you can't solve it. Because it's a stupid question.
And then he says it's stupid.
Yeah, it's based on, he didn't say it's stupid, it's based on a lie. Because the actual musical harmony that the orbits of the solar system are based on, that's what Kepler was looking for, and that's what he proved. Now, fast forward to Riemann. He says the geometry of physical space-time is not something in Euclid. It's not something you can take a priori. You have to investigate the principles that act in the universe that create the geometry. Right? And then, from there you get this general relativity, that the planets and other things move in space because of the curvature of space-time, which is generated by a universal physical principle. Okay? Now who said that before Einstein said it? That's what Kepler was doing.
Say it again. Say it again. One more time.
Einstein, using Riemann's method, his differential geometry and all that business, he's saying that, okay, the planets move not because of some force, but because there's a curvature of physical space-time that puts them in the orbits that they're in. And he has a whole general theory of relativity that explains that, but it's about curved space. Or, what is the geometry of space? It's not Euclidean. It's not so-called non-Euclidean. It's determined by the physical principles that are running the space. Okay, now what did Kepler say? He said that the physical principle of gravitation that's governing the motion of the planets is determined by musical harmony. But see, he says there is one. He says there's a reason that the Earth is 93 million miles away from the Sun, and Mars is whatever it is, 4 million, what is it, 4? 40 million or 40 billion, whatever. I can't remember. 44 billion, something like that. There's a reason that these planets are where they are and not some other place. And incidentally, there's an asteroid belt, or what you're going to call an asteroid belt later. He said there's an exploded planet there. So why does everybody think Newton was a advance over Kepler? Well, Kepler's basically saying, a preliminary version of what Einstein supposedly discovered. Because they don't want you to know. That's why you can't find out anything about Kepler if you go to college. Maybe you can learn Latin and then you can read Kepler in the original. But it's taken a long time for this stuff to get translated into English. And they deliberately published the fifth book of Mysterium Cosmographicum. I mean, not that, I don't know, the other one. Harmony of the Worlds, right? In the Great Book series.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
They don't give you the first four books, they just give you the fifth book.
Yeah.
And you read and say, what the hell is this?
Yeah, damn thing.
Yeah, they have a copy of the third book in the Harvard bookstore. The third book.
Yeah. Now, there's this book that was in the library. I have it at home. I guess I have to bring it in now. It has this whole thing about how Kepler discovered these wonderful laws, and it was the first time anybody that, you know, proved some kind of lawfulness to the orbits of the planets, right? Because Copernicus, you know, he said that the sun was at the center and the planets move around it, but they move in circles, and basically it's a Neo-Ptolemaic system with the sun at the center, right? But, you know, Kepler says, you know, the sun's at the center, but the planets are moving in ellipses. But the big deal is about the musical harmony. Now, this one book is supposed to be about calculus, like, attacks Kepler for being a mystic.
Yeah.
So he's trying to and what is this crap about music? What does this have to do? I told a professor about this before I quit Princeton about this stuff. He said, what does that have to do with anything? And I said, well, wait a minute. I'm taking quantum physics from you, right? You're telling me that the microphysical domain, I didn't use these words, I wasn't all that glib about it. You're telling us that the microphysical domain is quantized, that there's certain orbits of electrons and other things that, you know, the electrons don't float around the nucleus wherever they want, right? There's certain orbits, and there's certain numbers of electrons that can go into different orbits. It's organized. It's quantized. You can't go in between. You know what I'm saying? Right? If you heat up metal or something, you heat it up and then let it, you know, radiate, right? Or you use a laser or something, you know, blast it. And then the electrons, they radiate. They radiate at certain frequencies. If you go below the minimum frequency, nothing's going to happen. You have to excite the electron to it at a certain level. And if you go below that level, nothing happens. Right? That's how the photoelectric thing happens with, like, open the automatic door openers, right? If you're below the level of the frequency that's required to stimulate the electron, nothing happens, right? But it's quantized, just like the planets. The orbits are definite, and there's no in between. Okay, what does this have to do with what I was saying before? Well, you know, Leibniz is same thing. You got quanta. You have least action principle operating here.
You told your professor, and you're telling me that the solar system doesn't work like that? You didn't finish that sentence.
No, that's what I threw out to him. He was saying that Kepler's idea of musical harmony organizing the solar system has nothing to do with anything with the quantum physics. But, you know, that's all they talk about is quantization in the small. But it's also the solar system's quantized. But see, their mathematics and their physics, you know, they say Newton is the guy. But Newton's physics doesn't have anything to say about where the planets are. You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So I mean, Kepler is already more advanced than Newton, Lagrange, and Laplace, and all these other guys, and Cauchy. The reason we don't know that is, like I said, it's deliberate. They don't want you to know. That's why they teach the calculus this way. Because they don't want you thinking about, this isn't about physics. Now, I mean, look, I'm sure, you know, people made discoveries in physics that were trained in this Cauchy method. Why? Because they're human beings, and they wanted to make a discovery. So they don't let the math stop them, right? And I mean, people who get brainwashed by textbooks still are human, and they can make discoveries. But they do an experiment that contradicts what's in the textbook, and they insist, hey, this is reality, this textbook is wrong. Now, you know, the establishment, you know, they come down on people. We had this example of the cold fusion in '89. You know, these electrochemists, Fleischmann and Ponzi, did these experiments with deuterium, you know, they did electrolysis, sucking this deuterium, I think it was either deuterium or tritium, into these palladium electrodes. And the thing was putting out heat, and there's no current knowledge textbook explanation for it. Right? It wasn't a chemical reaction. So they said, oh, I guess it's a nuclear reaction. And then the physicists go, ape. They try to do the experiments, but they don't know how because they're not electrochemists. So they say, obviously, these guys are a bunch of frauds. And they drove them out of the country. That's MIT for you.
When we visited the nuclear plant at MIT, when we asked these guys about cold fusion, they started sweating. Got all nervous.
Yeah. You know, I remember being a kid and hearing about that. Mm-hmm. That there was this guy supposedly came up with nuclear fusion, but it was a big fraud and it was a lie.
Yeah.
And they were just trying to, like, make money out of a hoax.
Mm-hmm.
I remember hearing about that.
There's something going on. It may not be fusion, but it ain't chemistry, or it isn't what they think chemistry is. These guys are still trying to figure it out. Mm-hmm. There was a guy at MIT who was an environmental, I guess he was trained as an environmental engineer. Eugene Maloff, you ever hear of him? We actually had a forum at Harvard, of all places, where this guy was talking about, because he was one of the people who was trying to promote the cold fusion, and said, we've got to research this. Now, unfortunately, he was murdered last year. It's in the, he's from Connecticut, but he lived in New Hampshire. But he was at MIT, and he had to quit. He's trying to say, hey, man, this is a breakthrough. We got to look into this. They said no.
Yeah, wasn't he teaching?
I don't know. I haven't looked more into it.
How did he get wiped?
I don't know.
He was robbed in like some little town in Connecticut. Police.
Yeah, I think he was visiting his relatives or something. Yeah. That's the story.
Oh, shit.
So, Bill, one of the things.
But I just brought it up because this guy was at MIT and he had to leave. Not because, you know, you get my point, right? Don't let yourself be brainwashed. All right. You want to know how the universe is organized? You got to work with LaRouche. Right. If you want to get us out of this mess, you got to work with LaRouche because LaRouche is the guy that cares. He's actually interested in the organization of the universe, and making sure we have scientific breakthroughs and discoveries and more people and educated people. You know. But you can't lie. Like, this is a lie. This isn't how calculus was developed. This Cauchy business. And it's not the same idea.
It doesn't have anything in there about an infinitesimal change. Right? As far as I can see. In other words, they try to avoid the idea of an infinitesimal.
Let me just read it. Remember, Leibniz is the great genius that invented this notation. Okay? That everybody uses. All right, and they keep saying Newton or Leibniz. I'm going to leave Newton out of it. Leibniz knew how to obtain the integral and the derivative as limits, but the very foundation of the calculus were long obscured by an unwillingness to recognize the exclusive right of the limit concept as a source of the new methods. Leibniz could not bring himself to such a clear-cut attitude, simple as it appears to us now that the limit concept has been completely clarified. His example dominated more than a century of mathematical development, during which the subject was shrouded in talk of infinitely small quantities, differentials, etc. The reluctance with which these concepts were finally abandoned was deeply rooted in the philosophical attitude of the time and in the very nature of the human mind. One might have argued, of course, integral and derivative can be and are calculated as limits. But what, after all, are these objects in themselves, irrespective of the particular way they are described by limiting processes? It seems obvious that intuitive concepts, see, they use this word intuitive, right?
Block, isn't it?
Well, LaRouche says, you know, sometimes they mean well, but they're wrong on this issue. She used the term insight. Of course, he's attacking it. He's saying insight has no place in mathematics. It seems obvious that intuitive concepts such as area or slope of a curve have an absolute meaning in themselves without any need for the auxiliary concepts of inscribed polygons or secants or their limits. Indeed, it is psychologically natural to search for adequate definitions of area and slope as things in themselves. Okay, now this is an attack on Plato too, right? They attack in ideas. They're saying, but to renounce this desire and rather to see in limiting processes their only scientifically relevant definitions is in line with the mature attitude that has so often cleared the way for progress. In the 17th century, there was no intellectual tradition to permit such philosophical radicalism. Yeah, they just had guys that wanted to discover the laws of the universe. Right? That's what Leibniz was about.
There was no foundation to permit that kind of thing?
Yeah, these guys weren't rigorous. They just kept coming up with these methods of discovery that worked. But it was a big mess, and you couldn't understand it unless you were a philosopher. So, the hell with it. And, I mean, that's the way it's represented. The real story is they don't want thousands and millions of people to learn the method of Leibniz. Absolutely. A natural philosopher is interested in, you know, wisdom, right? Philosophy, right? Wisdom about the natural, about nature, right?
Quote Aristotle on that.
Okay, now listen to this. For the limit, the derivative which we call f prime x, that's what that thing is. This is the derivative. That's the definition of the derivative, which is what Leibniz would call see, this is the differential. Damn it, here. I keep trapping all this. Oh, there it is. Thanks. This is the differential, right? Cauchy and company, they don't talk about differentials. Talk about the derivative. But for them, this is a symbol. This is the symbol that they use to represent this. That's why they always say that Leibniz had this great notation that advanced science, but he didn't know what he's talking about. Or he was a mystic.
Is that the same thing
as that? Well, same as, it's like this over that ratio. They call it derivative. I think Leibniz called it a differential ratio. All right. Provided we understand that this symbol is solely an indication that the limiting process is to be carried out, there is no difficulty and no mystery. Before passing to the limit, that's what they call it, right? The denominator delta x and the quotient delta y over delta x is canceled out or transformed in such a way that the limiting process can be completed smoothly. This is always the crucial point in the actual process of differentiation. Had we tried to pass to the limit without such a previous reduction, we would have obtained the meaningless relation delta y over delta x equals 0 divided by 0, in which we are not at all interested. Mystery and confusion only enter if we follow Leibniz and many of his successors by saying something like this. Delta x does not approach zero. Instead, the last value of delta x is not zero, but an infinitely small quantity, a differential called dx. And similarly, delta y has a last infinitely small value, dy. The actual quotient of these infinitely small differentials is again an ordinary number, dy dx. Leibniz accordingly called the derivative the differential quotient. Such infinitely small quantities were considered a new kind of number, not zero, but smaller than any positive number of the real number system. Only those with a real mathematical sense could grasp this concept, and the calculus was thought to be genuinely difficult, because not everybody has or can develop this sense. It goes on, but you get the idea, right?
Man.
They want you to, you know, you can you can use the discovery, but they don't want you to understand it. They don't want you to be able to repeat it. And really, if you really want to understand what's going on, you got to read the monadology.
They don't understand the infinitesimal triangle.
Well, let me just say this. See, Leibniz was a disciple or a follower of, or, you know, he admired Kuza greatly. Kuza, he goes through this principle of the quadrature of the circle. The circle is a different species from polygon. And he also, he had this theorem that anything that implies that you can square a circle is necessarily false. And anything that, in any scientific proposition that derives from the impossibility of squaring the circle must be true. You ever hear that?
Say that again.
That's cool.
Any proposition that is a consequence of, well, if you say that you can square the circle, anything that follows from that is necessarily false. And any proposition that is a consequence of the impossibility of squaring the circle must be true. Remember, Phil was talking about this business about the infinite. And we get the flip side of it, right? The infinitesimal. But really, this is the issue of ideas, right? And this is Plato, right? Now, we said, remember this idea about the universe being made of work? Or remember what I said about LaRouche and this business about
the rate of increase of potential, which is not tangible. And that's why you actually need to be able to define this relationship between the integral and the infinitesimal. I mean, you know what I'm saying? Like,
yes.
That's the question that you're dealing with in a physical economic process. That's sort of dawning on you, so to speak.
Well, I was about to say about Kuza, all
right, cool.
Maximum minimum principle.
Yes.
Right? The relationship of the whole to the part.
Yeah.
Or the microcosm to the macrocosm. I mean, that's the key to everything in science.
But that can only be measured in terms of a relationship, I think, right?
Yeah, because you have to start from the whole.
Yeah, right. Because that'll define, yeah.
Alright, I mean, think about the scientific content of the idea that man is made in the image of God. There's an example. I like throwing the religion in there because it pisses off mathematicians.
Yeah.
Right. Pissed me off. I didn't like that stuff. Right? But how can the man be in the image of God? What's the characteristic of God? I mean, he's the creator, right?
Right.
Or the composer. That's the idea, right? We haven't explored that idea much today, but we can get on, you know, that's in the monadology and a few other things. But what's the principle of the creator? Creation, right? The good, you know, the fittest, the necessary being that caused everything. Now, how are we in the image of that?
Also participate in the development of creative ideas.
Yeah, we're the only other thing in the universe that creates something new. Mm. Right. And if you want to understand the way humans have to relate to one another, you got to understand the relationship of the individual to the universe as a whole, or this act, what's the principle acting, right? I mean, you can think about it, the catenary. The shape of the catenary is determined by the principle, and the principle acts at every infinitesimal location in the chain. And the slope of the chain is determined by that principle, right? The whole determines the individual. But in the individuals trace out the pathway that you know, generates the whole. So, I mean, look, it's philosophical. It's that's a deep idea. There's a lot there. Right? But you're not going to get that from these textbooks. Now, just one other thing on this business about the universe being made of work. Right? You create a new idea. You discover a new physical principle. And you apply it to mankind's practice. You're changing the laws of the universe. That's work. That's changing something. Right? Now, that's, and like I said, that's what LaRouche says is the substance of physical economy. And that's how we're in the image of God, because we can create these ideas. Now, I mean, there's a whole bunch of other things I'm going to go over about ideas, but we don't have time for that. But, I mean, like I said, this business attacking Leibniz on the question of metaphysics, right, or mysticism, that's the same attack as on Plato or on Kuza and Kepler. That's why you can't hear about them if you go to college. You're not going to get, you don't get those ideas because they don't want you to know. I think I should stop with this question.
Yeah, I got a question. Why does Riemann say, you're talking about this quantum thing with the atom?
Mm-hmm.
And, you're saying that this applies in the small and then in the large, too, in the solar system. Why does Riemann say investigations into the immeasurably small or immeasurably large, meaningless questions, but investigations into the immeasurably small, and then he's saying, goes on about that.
Right.
Why does he say that in the habilitation meditation? And then my other question is...
My first impulse is to say, well, like, nobody's perfect. But
I think he was setting something up.
I guess it's a little bit different question.
Let me
look at that context here.
And then my other question is, how the hell did LaRouche, I understand now, I'm getting a sense of the principles of how he forecast that, but still, how the hell did he do that? I want to know how is he able to figure that out?
That curve.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a good
question. I can describe some of it. I mean, there's some fusions back there that have some formulas and things. Yeah, but what does he say?
Yeah.
Well, I'll tell you why he stopped doing it. I think that was like the last one he put out. Maybe he put out forecasts in 84 and 85. But he stopped doing it. Because to make a forecast, you have to have data that's accurate.
Mm-hmm.
And he said virtually impossible to get that anymore. Mm-hmm. As of 83, 84. Because they lie about everything. You try to get the unemployment figures from the Bureau of Labor Statistics, and you know, they used to keep the military out of the labor force because they weren't producing anything. They weren't involved in the actual economy, right? They're off doing something else. In the mid-80s, they said, no, they're in the labor force. They threw them in, right? And then they used to keep people who were unemployed, and it was called part of the labor force, but they're unemployed. Now, one way to make the unemployment rate go down is to disregard everybody who hasn't worked past a certain point. Right? Another way to make it go up is to count people who are only working 3 days a week as being employed. When if you were going to tell the truth, you count them as being half employed. Or, 3 days out of five, or whatever. So, the idea that you could make a forecast based on the official data was absurd. But remember what he says there, that he's looking at the axiomatic assumptions that guide the policy. Because remember, he always says the forecast is based on, I mean, it's not a prediction, because what ends up happening is subject to people making decisions. And political leaders can always decide to get rational. Right? But if they don't, there's consequences. Think about this Euclidean business, right? All of the theorems that are supposedly true in the system of theorems all depend on the axioms and postulates. And if the definitions and axioms and postulates are all false, then the results are going to end up screwy. You know, the theorems will be false. If you try to, if you are, I mean, he's looking at physical economy. He's not looking at the money, except as it reflects what's going on in the physical economy. Right? Like if you disinvest in science, if you, you know, send your factories down to Mexico, right? Because you can get cheap people to do the same work cheaper, or some of it, for a little while. That's what they did in, you know, around the 1990s. You heard of NAFTA? North American Free Trade Agreement? They were doing it before that, but they basically made it legal, you know, that there were agreements between Canada, Mexico, and the U.S. that allowed for you to take a factory, you know, in Detroit that's making cars and paying people, whatever, $25 an hour. And you move the factory down to Mexico, and you can pay them, you know, $3 an hour, because for them, that's a lot of money. Right? And if they don't like it, then they can starve.
I was shocked, also, when they would invade, when German armies would invade, they would take all the factories out of Poland, ship it back to Germany, and then put slave labor to work on the factory.
Well, now you should say that, because the pamphlet we put out of was called NAFTA, Auschwitz Below the Border. Because the conditions in the maquiladora were hideous, or are. Is that increasing the potential population density? You say, oh, I can get this work done if I just, you know, get these poor Mexicans to do it. You know, we'll leave all the, we're going to increase our profit margin. We'll maybe leave a few hundred thousand Americans unemployed, but hey, that's business. What are you going to ask, Alex?
No, I was just thinking about what you were saying, that the time the forecast is also made by the thing that's made by the kind of thinking that goes into making the decision, like the kind of deregulation that they introduced, right, in the 80s, indicated the kind of policies that they wanted. I also thought about, what, based on what you were saying, if you think about the, Lenin one time described the Soviet, former Soviet Union, when they rejected the SDI, then he, based upon kind of directionality that is like, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Well,
he knew.
I'm sorry. You want to say something?
I was just going to say he knew what the potential economic boom would come out of the SDI if it was, you know, adopted, because the idea of it was not just you're going to build some kind of that's going to destroy missiles, but it was the idea that you have a crash program like. Like the space program to generate new technologies, you know, that would be very sophisticated, very powerful, energy dense, and use them for the military application of destroying missiles. But then you could use the spinoffs in the civilian economy the same way that you use all this stuff from Apollo in the civilian economy, and it's going to, you know, increase the productivity of the economy by an order of magnitude. And he was saying, look, we had to do that, and we should do it in cooperation with the Soviets, right? Let's spark a worldwide economic renaissance, right? And he could see that if they didn't do it, if the Soviets made the opposite decision, they said, no, we're not going to cooperate with you. We're going to continue our war production. We're going to expand our war production. We're going to take more and more of our economy and devote it to military expenditure so that we can conquer Western Europe. We're going to do that. He said, look, if you do that, your economy is going to collapse. He said it would take 5 years, and it took six. So, hey, what do you want?
Hey, Bill, I was wondering about this, the idea of outsourcing. And when we've been shutting down our machine tool jobs here,
yeah,
right, and then shipping, we're not actually shipping them overseas, right? Like, we're not, these businesses that go over to different countries and produce the stuff for cheaper,
mm-hmm.
that the labor force that's there is not, they're not building machine tools, right? They're just producing, like, products. Like, this is what I'm wondering is, because I get this argument, like, well, so what if we're shutting down a skilled labor force here? That skilled labor is now in another country. And I'm wondering, how is this stuff still being produced in another country without a skilled labor force?
Well, I should have a better answer for you, but frankly, they're not producing, you know, it's scaling back. most of the stuff that's getting produced out of these stuff is like cheap textiles, you know, and sneakers, you know. Spend $5 to make sneakers and then sell them for $100 here.
Well, how about like these car parts that are being produced in Mexico or something like that?
Yeah.
Are there machine tools like being produced cheaply or something?
Yeah, there was a demonstration the other day. How we're employing machine tools that are low quality and stick to them.
Oh, right.
Yeah, and I think we get a lot of the stuff from Europe too, and Japan. But even the so-called made in America cars are like mostly the parts are made somewhere else. And then somebody puts it together here and they call it made in America. And they put a yellow ribbon on it.
So you have nothing to say about the Remon thing?
What Remon thing?
That question I asked you about the Remon.
Oh, about the business about the meaninglessness of the questions of the astrophysically large. Let me just see here. Well, no, I'm not sure why he said that.
You probably, if you read through it again, you'll probably get an idea.
No, I remember he said that. Maybe he thinks it's just beyond the scale that you can do anything. It doesn't make much sense, though, because you can make the astronomical observations. So I don't know why you'd say that.
So the infinitesimal non-exactness of Leibniz is calculus because he wrote out that dx squared. Is that just a way of him showing that the universality of least action can't really be quantified by it? The way that Kepler kind of shows that the principles active in all these planets are not as or are more fundamental than powers acting upon them, more fundamental than quantifying their activity.
I'm not sure I understand your question.
I mean, how does Leibniz bring least action in his calculus together? Because the universality of the curvature of the catenary,
right,
is obviously more exact than the numerical representation of the area using this calculus because of that infinitesimally small neglected area. But yet he still came up with the least action and the universality of that.
Well, the least action is like the principle that he's looking for, right? I mean, well, I mean, remember he says his business about the principle of fitness? I mean, you could look at this catenary business like the principle acting is that the tension is being equalized over the curve. Another way to look at it is that the potential energy, not potential energy, the gravitational potential is at a minimum for this shape of this curve. He's looking for a principle of maximization or minimization or, you know, something that's unique about it. You get what I'm saying? Like with the bubble. It encompasses the greatest volume with the least amount of surface area, right? Also, if you have a soap bubble between two rings, you've seen that, right? That's a catenary shape too. And it's a catenary whether you have it this way or that way. Because there's a least action principle that determines the curvature of the soap. Given the it's a different boundary condition when you have a bubble just floating by itself. That soap connected by, you know, perfectly symmetrical. But if you got the two rings there, then that's a different boundary condition. But what's going on is the soap is minimizing the tension all the way around. And again, you get the same shape. So there's the principle, and then there's the mathematical description of it. But the thing is that you get this funny thing he discovers is a relationship between this catenary curve and the logarithmic curve. which we, now nowadays they would call it exponential curve, right? He actually shows how just by hanging a chain, if you look at certain proportions that are generated by a hanging chain, and